Canva Pro is a design platform that empowers you to create and share stunning content with just a few clicks.
We have used Canva since day one, as I always say, and Eva uses them now too. It's a great platform, and we send out all our Patreon cards on little Canva designs that I make, and so Canva has a very special place in my heart. I love it.
And with Canva Pro's content planner, you'll save time planning, creating, and posting social media content too, and pause scheduled posts and edit them at any time.
Design like a pro with Canva Pro. Right now, you can get a free 45-day extended trial when you use our promo code. Just go to canva.me/ATWWD to get your free 45-day extended trial.
That's canva.me/ATWWD. canva.me/ATWWD. Did you know that a simple finger prick can unlock tons of insight into your reproductive health? We're talking egg count, menopause timing, hormone levels that can show you things like thyroid disorders or PCOS, all things that are good to know whether or not kids are in your future.
Traditional testing with your doctor can cost over $1,000, but Modern Fertility gets you the same info at $159, which is a fraction of the price. And if you go to modernfertility.com/drink, you can even get $20 off your test. Plus, by the way, if you have an HSA or FSA, a lot of times you can put those dollars toward Modern Fertility, which is really great.
Right now, Modern Fertility is offering our listeners $20 off the test when you go to modernfertility.com/drink. That means your test will be $139 instead of the several hundred or even $1,000+ that it would cost at a doctor's office.
Get $20 off your fertility test when you go to modernfertility.com/drink. modernfertility.com/drink. Okay, I think we're good if you are.
I'm ready. By the way, fun fact, did you know that's how I sleep?
Wait, I sleep like that too, with my arms up?
Feels so
Haven't
good.
We talked about this?
I think I actually, we had a sleepover and our elbows kept bumping
elbows
into each other.
Our elbows kissed. Aww.
Oh, we should have looped our arms.
How
so
sweet.
We were like walking down a path together.
Yeah, but I sleep like this too. And sometimes my arms fall asleep. And so then in the morning I have to like pick them up.
Oh, that feels good. You know when it doesn't feel good is when your arm falls off the bed and like all the blood rushes to your fingertips.
Oh, yeah.
And
that
then
doesn't
like
feel good.
You try to move your arm and you're like,
oh. It's so heavy.
Like your arm is like the size of a building.
I think we should. I feel like if we have a sleepover soon, we should like put. I feel like somebody. No, we should probably lock all the doors. I feel like Blaze or somebody would walk in and be like, they're so weird. I feel like even when we sleep, we'd probably so fucking weird. Like, we'd
you know
probably
what would be
match.
So precious, though? Like, let's pretend God's taking an x-ray of us or something, right? Okay?
Okay.
Where are we going with
I don't
this?
Know. I'm going to close my eyes.
But if we had a sleepover together and then someone took like a little picture, then like it would be very cute if all three of us, the little baby was even sleeping with their arms like
okay,
that.
Okay, that's pretty sweet, yes.
He's so sweet.
I was like, where's this x-ray going? Now I get it. Yeah, there's another human involved. Got it.
It won't be for much longer. And like, give it like a couple weeks and then we don't need the x-ray machine.
But they actually we don't need that x-ray machine anymore. But they actually do sell like swaddles. One of the swaddles we bought has the arms like this because babies tend to sleep like that. So maybe that's why we
so
sleep
smart.
This way.
You know, speaking of swaddles and babies, there's nothing I love more than sleeping like a baby. And so there's this thing, I guess it probably existed for a lot longer, but it's only recently showed up in my Instagram feed, where it's basically an adult swaddle. And I can't wait to buy it. It's definitely going to be my next
impulse
purchase.
How do you put it on?
Someone
else have to put it on for you?
I think it's like those mermaid legs where you just kind of have to like shimmy in.
Or
maybe like you do like the jump in the old potato sack thing and then you dive onto the bed after
that
you're already
in. That seems like a lot of extra effort.
They never show you how it's put on,
yeah,
so I'm sure it's not cute, but
I can't wait for the unboxing and demo that you're going to do for all of us on camera.
Oh my gosh, did you see my little demo?
I woke up this morning, I had to pour my cereal, and I was like, oh my god, Em opened Mr. Tony's box. Yes, I watched the whole thing, Emothy.
It was beyond.
I'm so happy for you.
It's the blanket is like now I have kicked my Pendleton out of the way, my like $300
Pendleton.
Your beautiful
Pendleton. Gift that you received from your mother.
And yeah. My free Tony's Chocolonely blanket is now my new security blanket. So I was wrapped up in one of them, and the other, like the Tony's Chocolonely one, I was like just kind of snuggled with. I was like, Allison, move over. Big Tony is in the bed now. So
I got a new weighted blanket this week, so I think we're both on the blanket train.
Fun.
Yeah, it's a good time, you know. Trying to ease my restless legs.
How are you? What is your? Why do you drink this week?
Oh, great question. Well, you know what, we're finally finishing up the nursery, and it's on the side of the house that has always made me slightly uncomfortable, because it's like,
why did you do that to yourself?
It's the only, it's where the nursery goes. And so
great, by the way, like, spoiler alert to nobody, I hope, but like, be prepared for some really horrific ghost stories to come your way.
I know. We have like the little baby monitor, and I'm like, oh my god, I'm already scared to look at it. It's not even on.
Girl, get an infrared camera instead. Like, you're gonna need
No, I'll just use God's X-ray machine.
Oh, right. Yeah, that'll do. That'll do.
And so, oh, no. But like, there's something about this that has always given me the creeps. But so now,
so it's put your baby there. Good. Okay.
Right, exactly.
Your motherhood already at 100%.
And it's
maternal
it's,
instincts.
We put it up, we set everything up, it's beautiful in there, but like, I noticed recently, like, the cats and dogs don't like to go over there, and I'm like, this is not a good sign. But so, to be fair, for the first few months of their life, the baby will be sleeping in our room in a bassinet. So,
oh, good. So it will learn to feel safe. And then you will say, drop it off, go
on
away.
The other side of the house.
Also, like, I mean, obviously, kids are not in my near future. Your kid is, but mine is not. I like to think, like, I know my kid's going to be traumatized in some way. Like, there's just there's no way we're going to avoid that. There's something's going to make that kid a mess, like, mm-hmm. I am. Mm-hmm. And I always wonder what that thing is going to be. You don't have to wonder anymore.
Oh, yeah, you've already, I got it covered.
You've already made the call. You're like, oh, I'm going to, you know, put it in the place I, an adult, don't want to be.
I mean, honestly, like, if it's just some ghostly trauma, like, fine. I mean, that's all right, right? That's better than some other trauma, you know, that I feel
your
like
your baby's
going to
start pointing at things, and the baby's going to be like, my best friend. And you're going to be like, you're an infant. How are you talking? And also, why is it in Latin?
Why are there so many teeth? Don't worry. So anyway, I've already planned this whole thing about M visiting me before Mothman, and I just have big plans, so I can't wait.
You're
to show
you.
You're
gonna put me in the nursery. I'm
Can
so
you imagine?
Sad.
I put you in the toddler bed.
I can't imagine. I think you're gonna first of all make me build it, and then I think you're gonna make me sleep in it.
I already stapled all the curtains to the wall. Don't worry. That would make it really janky.
Oh, is that not your aesthetic, Christine? I'm sorry.
Christine. It's my aesthetic. It's not the baby's aesthetic, okay? It's my aesthetic. I nail my curtains to the wall. Don't worry
I
about
like
it.
How aesthetic-wise, where I know you've stapled something to a wall. I know you have.
You're gonna
and I don't know
it.
What it is.
You're going to wander around and find it.
At least you don't do it in the baby's room, so the baby has a safe space in the exact unsafe space.
Yeah. I want to at least make it physically safe, not metaphysically, you know?
Right,
it's one
right,
way.
Right, right.
Why do you drink this week, Emothy?
I drink, well, for your baby, who can't drink yet. I also drink, oh my gosh, wait, oh wait, oh, what, I just thought about the first time the baby makes an appearance. Can the baby be drinking a bottle? And then we can go, why do you drink? And then the baby will be like, I'm fucking traumatized over here. Can you help me?
Honestly, we could do a breastfeeding, and then it'll be like some weird viral thing. We'll be like,
yeah,
breastfeeding on camera. But no.
What?
Let's do the bottle. But we'll see.
I'm fine with either. I'm sure the baby would be fine with either. But really, when it's like, and why do you drink, little baby? The baby will be like, help me.
SOS.
No, why do I drink? Yesterday, I have an answer. Yesterday, I decided that I was going to give myself a relaxing day.
Oh.
Because I, just going back and forth to Florida so many times and seeing my family is just a lot. And I feel like I've kind of been like running around nonstop. And I was like, I'm just going to vibe. I'm just going to like
that for you.
Do my thing. And so, and then I was explaining it, like the things I did. And I was like, I sound like I'm in the 40s, like not in my 40s. I'm in the
1940s.
Because I got my London Fog in the morning, obviously.
Of course.
And then, but then I like went to the general store and had a sandwich, and then I went to the barbershop, and then I went down to the ice cream parlor. I was like, what is
you
wrong with
me? You tossed
a
nickel to the young man on the corner. What on earth?
I went to the comic book shop just to stroll around. But I literally went to the, like, we have a diner. We have a local literal general store called the General Store.
I didn't know about
that. We have a local barbershop that's not too far from me, which is where I got this, like, gaudy hairstyle.
Gaudy and then, hairstyle. It's my and then, gaudy. You look great.
And then I went to the, like a literal diner and had a cherry Coke. Who the fuck am
Wait,
I? And like,
that's
I,
hysterical.
I didn't even mean to do all those
you
things
didn't
in that
phosphate.
Order.
And
what are they called? The egg creams. No, but I did all those things, and then after I was explaining the things I did, I went, what was wrong with me today? I was like,
what did you enter a portal or something?
I know. I was like, all that combined sounds like I had a really specific, intentional
like an aesthetic
day
you were going
to
for.
Like, yeah. Live out a history.
Okay,
or something.
But to be
anyway.
Fair, then you opened a Tony Chocolonely. That also sounds pretty damn 40s, you know. So like, you kind of fit the aesthetic, like Tony's.
And then
Chocolonely.
You know, Big Tony came
Big
over
Tony
and he dropped off a package for me. You know, I said, okay, all right,
and then you bought yourself a baby swaddle.
I haven't bought that yet. To be fair, that's in the modern days.
That's in the shopping list on Instagram. Got it.
Yeah. Wow. Anyway, that's why I drink, because I was sitting there. The general store literally looks like an old ass general store.
I love that.
And they make like little sandwiches. And so aww. I sat there and I intentionally didn't use my phone. So I just was kind of like living in the moment. And I was like, whoa, this is even pretty old school of me.
Not using your phone. Yeah. Looking around just at people.
Sitting in a place with a bunch of baskets and mason jars on the ceiling and just living, you know.
Did you read a newspaper? That would have been excellent
stuff.
If
there was one, I would have done it. But
wow.
No. Wow. Anyway, all of that to say I had a good day yesterday. So that's
it. Sounds like it.
I'm feeling kind of like vegged out. In
yeah,
a
you're
cool
like vibing.
Way, so.
I love it.
Yeah, just good bouncing around with my shitty hair. Anyway,
come on. I like your hair. It looks great.
It looks silly, but luckily, if I like just, you know, push my hair out really hard, it'll start growing again. Like
that's,
I'm a Play-Doh doll. So
it's a very special talent you have.
Just really think hard, you know. If you do it for two weeks or so, the hair will start showing.
That's
up,
actually
so.
Pretty incredible, miraculous.
Once again, here we are in a world where we all have to listen to Christine talk about her chest. And by the way, how useful Third Love has come into her world and making your chest a little happier.
That's
right.
I
imagine.
They do, and they're a mainstay in my life. If you need more support, I think a lot of us do, Third Love's number one best-selling 24/7 classic t-shirt bra provides all the comfort and support you need in more than 80 sizes. You heard that right, 80. Every Third Love bra is made with signature memory foam cups, super comfortable, no slip straps, which is one of my pet peeves when the straps fall down, and a scratch-free band from cups AA to I, including half cups, which is like a game changer.
It's like when SpongeBob's grandma knitted him that sweater made out of love with every stitch. Third Love obsesses over every stitch, so you never have to think about how something feels, looks, or wears. It's just already gonna be made with love, just like SpongeBob's grandma.
Third Love knows you deserve to feel comfortable and, like SpongeBob, confident 24/7. So right now, they are offering our listeners 20% off your first order.
Go to thirdlove.com/drink now to find your perfect fitting bra and get 20% off your first purchase.
That's thirdlove.com/drink for 20% off today. I have an update, which is that I couldn't help myself and I bought more Brooklinen products, and I bought the towels this time. They are extremely plush and comfortable, and when you're visiting me before Mothman, I already set two aside that are like the newest, coziest ones, just so that, you know, I feel like I have like a little high quality guest area for you with some nice towels, Brooklyn.
If
towels.
There's not a mint on those towels, I walk. Also, meanwhile, I also just got some new Brooklinen sheets, and they have been keeping me so cool in the middle of the night. It's been getting really hot here. I am a very hot sleeper, and Brooklinen has been there for me. Brooklinen was started to create beautiful, high-quality home essentials that don't cost an arm and a leg.
Brooklinen has something for your every comfort need, ideal for a seasonal refresh. Apparently, that's what we're doing here, because they're launching new products, colors, and patterns all the time. So give yourself the comfort refresh you deserve and get it for less at Brooklinen.
Go to brooklinen.com and use promo code ATWWD to get $20 off with a minimum purchase of $100. That's BROOKLINEN.com and enter promo code ATWWD for $20 off with a minimum purchase of $100.
That's brooklinen.com, promo code ATWWD.
Here is my story for you, and I don't know how I never covered this before, but this is a whole village of ghosts. Christine.
What? Wait, my story is a village too.
Of ghosts or of
no,
killers?
But like of crime.
Oh.
But I've never even done a village. It's literally a village where
I have no idea what you're talking about immediately. Like a commune?
Sort of, yeah.
Ooh.
But like that's so weird because it's like a whole, the story is like of the village. Your story is of a village of ghosts. That's really freaky.
Ah, we're the village people. Fun. Okay. So so here is my story. This is Pluckley Village.
I don't know what this is, but I'm amped.
So it's in England. It's near London. And it's like, I say that because apparently it's near Kent, which is near London.
Okay.
If I'm getting that right. So it's like 2 degrees of separation away from London.
Okay.
But it is England's most haunted village.
Holy shit.
Which, by the way, is verified by the Guinness Book of World Records.
I didn't know that was a category, but okay.
I also did not know it was a category. Also, it is no longer a category. I wonder because they were like, how do you vet this? You know,
like how do you quantify it? I guess. Yeah.
But I guess they've said this was in 1989. Guinness said, all right, you're the most haunted.
It's a weird year for Guinness.
And it was a good year for Pluckley Village because if they, like Guinness, like officially stated it and then like never did that category again.
Right.
So like Pluckley's just like officially it.
They like swept in, grabbed the trophy and ran. Yeah. Yep. Love that.
So there's at least a dozen ghosts here, but it could be up to 16. But they say there's on record at least 12 ghosts. There are also some other paranormal-based Guinness World Records. Would you like me to read them to you?
Absolutely, please.
Okay, perfect. Getting my glasses on. Professor Schultz is in the house. Okay, so the most participants in a paranormal scientific study.
Oh.
Do you want to guess how many people were in this study?
60.
Yeah. No. It was...
Yeah, it was like, good for me. Oh, never mind.
So in 2000, there was a study where 1,027 people all were a part of this study where they just documented their experience at a haunted place together.
Oh, shit. Okay.
So the location was called the Hampton Court Palace, which I guess is really haunted. And they just walked around.
Was Zeebe there? Or was he not part of this? Is he just still upset?
Shockingly, Zeebe was not there.
He's probably upset he's not, that he wasn't there.
He's probably thinking, I will now compete for the most participants in a paranormal study.
1,203 or whatever.
Yeah.
Plus one person.
1,028 people.
28. Yeah. Add Aaron to the mix.
Aaron, get to Hampton Court Palace quick. So another one is the largest Ouija board. Do you want to guess how big the Ouija board is?
40 feet
long. It's bigger in feet than there were people at that one study.
Oh, shit. Okay, 1,500 feet wide.
Close. It was 1,302.
I can't even picture that in my head. So
I don't know.
But that sounds huge.
Oh, you know what? Well, I don't know it in, I don't know it in my mind as the shape of a rectangle. But
yeah.
This apartment is 1,250. So 50 square feet more would be the Ouija board.
Oh, wait. So it was 12 something.
It's 1,300 square feet. Or square. I don't know. Yeah, it is. 1,300 square feet.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it's like,
wow.
Shorter in length than that.
It's, that's still a lot. For, apparently that's 121 meters squared. For those of you who don't use feet, that's fucking big.
That is big. Although my guess was bigger with a 1,500 feet long.
That's true. I think about like the piano at F.E.O. Schwartz you can like dance
yes,
on.
Completely.
I feel like you're one of the letters at that point on a Ouija board.
How cool. You could be like as a ghost, you could literally just walk around and like
yeah.
carry planchette.
That's what it is. It's the F.A.O. Schwartz piano for ghosts.
That's right. And actually, did you know that I bought my first Ouija board at F.A.O. Schwartz in New York City?
No. I got my first one as a birthday present for my 10th birthday party in 5th grade. And I remember it being a real crisis because it was Virginia and my 10th birthday party was a Harry Potter theme party. And so some Christian kids...
Oh,
couldn't
God.
Come to the party. And then we were like, no, it's going to be fine. And then one of the presents I got was a Ouija board. And their parents were like, okay,
it went
gotta
off
go.
The rails.
Anyway, okay. Oh, here's two more. Okay. The most viewers in a live streamed seance is...
Most viewers in a live streamed seance.
So, like, a seance being... No. So, I'll give you context, and it will make total sense.
Okay.
It happened to be in November 2020. So, it was the day after Halloween when we were all inside. So, take a guess on how many people were on this stream.
4 billion.
It was 9,300 people on Facebook. So, almost 10,000 people.
How come we weren't there? That sounds fun.
We were having our own mini one the literal same day.
Oh my god, you're right. We were doing a fucking seance together. For Patreon.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, seance so maybe a strong word, but you know.
Ish. We were hanging out with ghost equipment in the And That's Why We Drink apartment. Yeah. But that's why there were 9,000 people less, because they were all on this Facebook event, you know?
Think about how many we would have had if all of those folks had come to our party instead.
It's exactly why we had so few people there.
We had that many people. We had snacks for that many
people. We had virtual seats for 10,000 people, and only like 1,000 came.
We had enough cheese balls, enough Natty Light, and like we still have leftovers. It's actually really sad.
Here's my favorite. This is the last one too. But my favorite paranormal record.
Okay.
The most expensive ghosts. What does that mean?
What does it mean? I love that that's a fucking category. I don't know.
So there are two vials of allegedly exorcised spirits from New Zealand.
What?
And they sold in 2010. And in New Zealand money, it was $2,830. For us, it would be $1,990. And it was also 1,300 quid, just for everyone, conversion wise.
$1,900. For a vial of ghosts.
It was $10 shy of $2,000 for us. So it was basically $2,000 for two vials of exorcised spirits. Probably went to Zach Bagans, to be clear.
I was going to say, he got it for a steal, honestly.
That man loves a spirit auction. anyway, those are just some fun facts. But the most important one is that Pluckley has been deemed the most haunted village in England. So,
okay.
And also, like, anywhere in England is so fucking old that I am shocked that the record is there's only 12 ghosts in this village and that makes it the most haunted. Like,
yeah.
I feel like all of England, wherever you step, there should be, like, a minimum, like, 700 guaranteed ghosts.
Yeah, like, per square foot. Yeah, I agree.
I don't know if that just means the 12 that were documented that day or whatever, but okay. So, Pluckley is based in Kent, just outside of London. There it is. And it was the location setting I saw on one website. It was like, it's most famous for. And I was like, really? I've never heard of this. But maybe if you're from the UK, you've heard of this. It was the location setting for the series The Darling Buds of May TV show.
That sounds like something made up making fun of England. That sounds like an SNL sketch.
It really does. Actually, I hadn't even thought of it. But yeah, it sounds exactly like...
I love the BBC.
It sounds like satire. The Darling Buds of May.
Oh my god, that's great.
Fun fact.
I'm sorry, I'm probably insulting like everybody who's like, oh, I love that show.
I mean, we don't... Hello, we have Jackass, so...
Yeah,
like,
all right, we're not here to compare quality of our content, but...
I'm sure The Darling Buds of May was just as delightful as it sounds.
Absolutely.
I imagine it's like their Little House on the Prairie or something.
It sounds like it.
So, of the people who starred in the show, one of them happened to be future famous Catherine Zeta-Jones.
Oh, shit. Okay. Wow.
So, Katie knows what's up. She's like, I was a darling bud. How dare you?
She's like, excuse me.
Pluckley has been its own village, or has been established, I guess, since the 11th century. So, yeah.
Oh, okay. Sure.
There's just no way in my mind there's only 12 ghosts.
Standard.
And in 1955, that was the first mention of these towns, of the town's ghosts in writing or in print, because a guy named Frederick Sanders wrote, Pluckley was my playground. And I guess there is where he mentioned some of the local lore. So since the 50s, at least, the ghosts I'm going to mention have been discussed.
Okay.
Again, I'm shocked that if this town has been around since the 11th century, only like 60 years ago, they started talking about ghosts. This feels a little off to me, but we're riding with the research.
Okay.
In the same time frame, though, that this Pluckley Was My Playground came out and people started reading about the ghost stories, in the same time, in the 1950s, there was an article in the TV Times about Pluckley, I imagine because of the Darling Buds of May. And they were interviewing residents who actually lived in Pluckley and what it was like living there. And one guy named Desmond Carrington admits that in the interview for TV Times, he made up a bunch of ghost stories. So there's a chance that all of the ones I'm talking about are like associated through him. And then
don't
just
say that
over the decades, like just it became local lore. So it's I just want to state that like there is proof that someone out there like admittedly lied to the press about like this place being haunted.
Well, if the Guinness Book of World Records is relying on one man in one article, then like,
okay, that's true.
You know, I don't know. I like to think they at least got a couple people confirming ghost sightings.
Yeah, so okay, you've got on one side, this one guy lied to the media about ghosts. On the other side, the literal Guinness Book of World Records says that this place is haunted. And in the middle, you've got me who says this place is nearly 1,000 years old. Like, I'm pretty sure there's a ghost. Like, there's at least
the
one.
Mediator. Like, come on, guys.
It's like, for once, using ghosts as my argument is like the most logical thing I've ever done. So, okay, so Pluckley Village and the ghosts have been discussed on a lot of news shows and TV shows. It's probably most famous for being on these a few series, one of them being Strange But True, Most Haunted, Midsummer Murders, and Celebrity Haunted Hotel Live, BBC's Top Gear, and also Ghost Hunters International. So
okay.
It's been around the block. Uh-huh. So the family that we're talking about with Pluckley Village is the Darings. I guess Pluckley Village is small enough that basically the Darings have near complete control of the entire property.
Now, is this spelled like Darlings but without an L?
No, but actually I wonder, it's Daring D-E-R.
Okay, I was like, that would be quite a strange twist.
You know what? Like, I'm in the 1950s, the Daring family was still very already well established in Pluckley Village. And if they're already doing a show based in Pluckley, I wonder if they were reading up on the research and Daring, like, helped spark.
And
the
I'm
name.
Pretty sure Darling is the family in Peter Pan. So, you know, maybe there was some, we'll just kind of tweak their name a little bit.
Maybe Catherine Zeta Jones was actually Wendy, you know?
It could be.
I think actually Darling Buds of May is part of a poem or something.
Oh.
I think that might be where it came from. But I don't know. I
was like, Em, are you sure you didn't just accidentally forget the L in the word Darling? I'm such an asshole.
But how quickly it goes from like really precious and sweet and wholesome to like kind of like threatening of like the Daring Buds
the
of May.
The Daring family. That's true. That's true.
And then all of a sudden I'm thinking of like horse races and cowboys and stuff. Okay. Oh, because it could be the Daring Buds, like Friends.
That's what I thought. Yeah, like buddy, buddy rom-com or whatever.
And Darling
called.
Buds, like the little sweet cherubs that they are. Oh, wow. Aww. It really takes a complete turn with that one letter missing from the whole
That's
thing.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah.
Okay. So the Daring family, D-E-R-I-N-G.
Got it.
During Henry II's reign, the Daring family inherited a manor at Pluckley. And I guess ever since either they still own the property or everything is still named after them. The history is still all about their family. The property was big enough that it nearly covered all of Pluckley. So it's basically the Daring estate when you go into Pluckley Village. Fun fact, there is a type of window all around Pluckley that is named after the Darings because during the Civil War, one of the Darings was captured during the war and he escaped by going headfirst through a window. And I guess to commemorate the experience of him like escaping being a prisoner of war by running through a window, they made all of the windows in town look like his window. Because I guess it brought luck to them.
What did his window look like?
The description I saw online was that they have round tops and I don't know, Daring window.
It's just so random.
Daring window.
I'm gonna match all the windows.
Oh, it's, I mean, it looks kind of, well, I was gonna, it probably sounds super ignorant and American, but they look like windows at like a Renaissance fair. So so I'm sure all of England, it's in some places still might have that aesthetic. Here, I just sent you a picture.
Okay. Oh,
They're like round on the top and not on the bottom.
Yeah. What do you call that? Arched windows.
I call it a daring window.
It's dumbass. It's an arched window. All right, everybody.
Yeah. So apparently he went head first through one of those windows and that's how he escaped. And I guess because it signified luck, they made a lot of the windows on the estate and therefore most of the village.
It signified luck windows. To go head first out a window, I guess. I mean,
yeah, you know what? They really took the high road in that story, I guess.
Yeah, they were like, let's make this a good, let's spin it to a good thing.
Yeah. We're going to shop
it. PR team.
Well, they were the Darings and they owned most of the land. So.
That's true.
So anyway, fun fact, there's a window named after them. And after being deemed the most haunted village in England, apparently, so this is as of 1989, a bunch of like paranormal nerds, aka people like us, started like flooding the town.
Oh.
And so it very quickly got so bad that police had to stop people from coming in and they had to show like proof of residence to even be in Pluckley. Because there was like property damage and shit.
That's horrible.
One reference said that like rocks were getting thrown at a school.
Like, what on earth are you doing? If you're there to see ghosts, don't, like, vandalize.
Yeah, someone else, or on another website, I think I saw that there was, like, a fire got started. It got really dramatic really fast. So the cops ended up having to say, like, you can't even be here. So I think it has a love-hate relationship with the fact that it's got this title.
Sure.
Anyway, there was, that's pretty much all the history, but the Darings do come up a lot, so I wanted to mention them. I actually don't think I officially added up all of the ghosts. I just wrote down every single one I could find online. There's definitely at least 12, but now I'm just reading the ghosts to you. That's the rest of the story, is me just telling you what ghosts are.
I'm so excited. I love this.
So there is the Black Horse Inn, which it has been around since the 14th century, and it is part of the Daring Estate.
Uh-huh.
Apparently, it was gifted to the Darings from King Charles II. Can you imagine being, like, that tight with, like, a king? And they're like, here you go.
Here's a tavern. There's a keg already inside. Like, what? Right.
Okay, but also, if I could give you any gift, I would totally be like, oh, here's a tavern with a keg inside.
Honestly, like, I would never accept any gifts from anyone ever again. I'd be like, sorry, I already got the coolest gift of all time. It's a tavern.
Honestly, if you could gift me anything, I know I've mentioned this before, but my mom and I really want to open up like an old school ice cream parlor.
Okay, I was like, if you just say again right now how my family all owned candy shops, I was like, I feel like you've said that 16 times.
I definitely have. No,
that you and your mom, I forgot about that. But yeah, that's very cute.
If you could give me any acreage and property, I would love.
I could give you some, like, maybe in Kentucky, not in Burbank. I think maybe my pocket won't go that far, but
you can give me your haunted ass nursery until I get evicted for the new renter.
Well,
so
we purchased next door. I don't know if I ever talked about this. We purchased as part of the, we didn't purchase it, but it came with the property, an abandoned dentist's office. So you could have that. It's so super creepy in there.
But Christine, I do need to like request that you don't touch that until I'm there, because I obviously want to investigate it with you.
Yeah, you need to come in there with me. There's like a staircase that goes downstairs, and only my sister's the only person that's ever gone down there, because it's like,
Christine, why don't we just stay the whole night there? Oh my god, that sounds so fun. Your baby's right next door.
I'm pretty sure that my house is more haunted than that fucking dentist's office.
Ooh, okay.
Unfortunately. But
I'm
going
to have to stay for a long time.
I have like a dirt basement with like stone walls. And
a
it has
dirt
like,
basement?
Yeah, my dude.
Oh, my God.
And it has,
it's not finished?
It. No. No, it's certainly not finished. Most of the house is not finished. But it has like an old stove, like oven where they used to like heat the water, because, you know, back in the 1800s. And it's like all empty now, obviously. But you can like walk through the old like oven where cistern where they had all the water. It's all brick. It's very creepy. Anyway, I'm excited to show you.
Whoa. Christine, I'm going to have to, speaking of infrared cameras, we're going to have to buy out like 1,000 of them. And then or maybe baby monitors. Maybe they do the same thing and they're cheaper. But
they're not,
I need to go
cheap,
like,
but
we're about to go play Ghost Adventures, and I'm going to volunteer to be Aaron. I'm pretty sure I want to like go hang out in that dentist office of
fun.
The cistern.
Also, the basement has, you have to go through a trap door to get down there. So that'll be part of the fun too. Just a heads up. You might have to help me get down the stairs, but there's a trap door in my living room that you have to open. It's underneath the couch.
Realistic, I mean, I kind of blacked out when you said all of that because I just, I think my body
told,
was.
I feel like I've told you this before, but.
I think I blacked out then too, maybe. Oh, okay. Realistically, in the game of Ghost Adventures, your baby is Aaron because, like,
they, poor baby.
They did not choose to be here. And also, you're like, oh yeah, go be in this nursery by yourself.
Sorry,
all night.
Shutting the door. Bye.
I'm gonna get your baby a onesie with Aaron's face on it.
No, please don't.
Just so they know their place.
No, not gonna happen.
Okay, so it'll just have my face on it. Don't worry.
Yeah, that'll accept.
Black Horse Inn, gifted them by King Charles. There was a manager named Laura who says that she was once having tea there and she watched a cup on the shelf move a little bit and then all of a sudden it slid all the way to the very edge of the shelf. So if it moved anymore, it would have fallen, which is such a weird little fuck you. It's like,
it is.
The ghost intentionally just wanted to give, just like stress you out. like also, you almost watch a cup shatter.
I love the little teeter, like testing it out. Like, let me see if I can move. Oh, okay. Let's push it.
Like, are you noticing yet? Oh, you are now that you're noticing.
Tickle, tickle.
That's awful. Just always wondering if your dishes are about to fall.
It's not good. No.
She also apparently saw a disembodied hand rearranging their silverware in the restaurant at one point.
Oh, no.
Which I always love the passive aggressiveness of that.
So like, passive aggressive.
Whenever the ghost is like, let me do it for you, you're clearly not doing it right.
Yep.
And apparently this is in a room where the animals hate going in and they regularly bark at by itself. So. Two other managers who have been at the Black Horse Inn say that the living room one time completely filled with smoke, even though no fire had started.
Oh, dear.
But, like, it was bad enough that they called 911. They thought there was a fire and they couldn't find the location. But they did say it was weird because the whole time it didn't smell like a fire.
Ew.
So that's pretty creepy that you're just in a room filled with smoke and you think you're going to, like, probably die of, like, smoke inhalation. And then you find out it's just
there's nothing.
Like, you go back in the house and nothing was there to begin
with. That's terrifying.
Although the fire didn't smell like smoke, there have been bad odors there. There's also been a lot of cold spots. Things move in the corner of your eye and also apparently directly in front of you. Items go missing and then they come back way later, like after you've forgotten that they even went missing. And then people hear footsteps and people's clothes have been tugged on.
I like the idea of things going missing until you don't care anymore because it's sort of like... they want to annoy you to the extreme that, like, when it matters, it's not going to be there. And then, like, the second you don't care anymore, they're like, fine, have it back. I'll find something new to hide.
It also feels like a little kid of, like, I want to bother you, but once, like, you've stopped caring, the game's not fun anymore for me.
That's what I'm saying. Like, the second it doesn't matter anymore, it's like, well, what's the fun here?
Yeah. Anyway, so that just sounds like a really obnoxious ghost.
Mm-hmm.
And then there is the Church of St. Nicholas, the parish church of St. Nicholas, which apparently is the Diocese of Canterbury, which is pretty cool. Sounds pretty insane. It's from, I think the website says that it was from the year 1093. So literally almost 1,000 years old, this church. Mm-hmm. Several of the Daring family members are buried there. And there are reports of a moving light by the windows. People hear knocking from under the floor, which is going to be what you hear when I'm in your basement.
And I won't let you out of my basement.
And then what is there always one of in a ghost story?
Let's see. A woman in white, a woman in red, a woman in black.
So there's a woman in white and a woman in red. So
no
there's two
way.
Of them. And they both are at the Church of St. Nicholas.
They're competing.
And you know what's so stupid about this lady in red? Not to insult her, but...
Wow.
Not to insult her, but it's so stupid. Well, it's not her fault. It's other people's description of her.
What?
That she's called the lady in red, but her and the lady in white are both in white. Like,
did she spill like spaghetti sauce? Like, why do they call her?
Is she Christine?
Is it me? Hold on.
She apparently was holding a rose when she was buried.
That's not the same.
Was holding a rose either when she was buried or there was a rose on her coffin when she was buried or
she seemed
carrying a rose.
I feel like you could call her creepy, like the rose lady. Like, that alone is creepy. Why add in red?
Or also, like, why don't you just say, like, blonde and brunette or something else? Like, some other factor. Like, why?
Yeah.
It's like every story is so determined to have a fucking lady in red that they were like, she's not even in red, but we're going to give it to her.
What if her accessories is red? I guess we'll just make that count.
Yeah. Okay. So anyway, lady in red, she's often seen in the churchyard. The difference here is the lady in red is seen outside. The lady in white is seen inside.
Okay.
So in the 1970s, I'll get back to the lady in red, the lady in white in a second, but this is my favorite story from this church, is that apparently in the 70s, there was a group of investigators who, like, kind of schmoozed their way into letting the reverend let them in and stay at the church overnight.
Oh.
And they stayed all night, and the next day when the reverend, his name was John Pittock, he let them out, and he was like, oh, like, did anything happen? They said literally nothing happened. It was so boring. All they did that whole night was just, like, hang out with the dog. And then the reverend went, we don't have a dog.
Okay, that's pretty wild. I just got chills.
Yikes. The worst part is, like, with a dog, it's one thing if you're like, oh, I was hanging out with, like, that guy who, like, sat in the shadows and told us his tale. Like, that's creepy enough. But with a dog, like, you know, we all know how I would be with a dog that
was
friendly.
It's, like, very alive. Like, it's, like, very.
Very, like, not only in your face, but at part, like, literally, like, up against your fucking mouth a lot of times. Because if I saw a dog who wanted to hang out with me, I'd be cupping its little furry face. I'd be kissing its nose. I'd be going, mwah. And it's dead. It's a ghost. It's not even real.
Like, I don't understand that how you, yeah, that's really wild. That's pretty creepy.
Did it have dog breath? Even, like, I wonder, you know, were they like, wow, this dog's breath is pretty amazing. And then they should have known.
Did it play fetch? Did it carry something back?
Did you rub its belly? Like, what happened here? Like, that's a lot of physical interaction
with a ghost. I would think with a dog, yes, agreed.
Like, that's insane. So, apparently, the dog didn't exist, which also makes me wonder if you weren't part of that group and you were just kind of, like, watching from another room, did they all look like they were, like, miming, playing with a dog? Yeah. Anyway.
Talking in, like, puppy speak to, like, nobody except a bunch of other men.
But what does that tell you about, like, the ghosts there immediately know that the people in the church, like, the investigators, all the ghosts know that they were probably super nice people because all you hear from them all night is going, oh, you were a little cutie pie. It's so sweet. So it's like, I mean, that's a great way for the ghosts to vet us and, like, how...
Just send the dog in.
Yeah. It's like, do we even want to haunt this person?
Puppy.
Because what if they treated that ghost dog like crap and then the other ghosts come in saying, like, don't fuck with my dog. And
yeah,
then
how dare you get... That's a good excuse for, like, now I can fuck with these people.
Mm-hmm.
They badmouthed my dog.
Back to the lady in red and the lady in white. So the lady in red was, I don't know if this was, like, part of a tradition back then. I feel like I have never heard of this before. So, but both of them, I guess they were respected in the area, and they weren't just buried in one coffin. They were buried in, like, layers of coffins.
What? What do you mean?
So they were the lady in red. And also, to be fair, I don't know if this is, like, it's true about one and inspired lore about the other, or if this is true for both of them. But at least with one of the women, sources said the lady in red, she was allegedly buried in a coffin made of oak and then seven more coffins made out of lead.
Oh, like around her.
Like one of those, like the dolls.
A box in a box in a box in a box.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, I thought you meant like she was dismembered and buried in seven coffins.
No.
I was like,
I mean, like,
seem respectful at all.
When Yzma wants to put Kuzco as a flea in a box.
Yeah. Correct. So wait, okay, that sounds more like she's a vampire in my
head. That sounds like some vampire shit, right? Or maybe it's because I don't know when she died, but my best guess without any information is I know that, like, Pluckley really, I saw that in their history, they really suffered during, like, the plague.
The plague,
maybe they thought,
like,
that
a sickness thing.
Maybe this was part of their routine when people would die during the plague because they were afraid
of catching
it.
Sounds like a lot of
work. Or maybe it was, like, just so you didn't smell decomp. I don't know. But, like, seven lead coffins,
like,
around
that sounds
a wooden
to
one?
Me like something bad.
That sounds like they wanted her to never be able to come
to
back.
Never come back.
So,
and then they're like, here's a rose. Bye. Like, it just seems such a weird,
like,
combination.
A little mwah, for your troubles.
Yes, like toss it in. Oh my god.
So, and then apparently, so one of them was an oak coffin with seven lead coffins around it. Another one was an oak coffin with three lead ones around it. I don't know if that's
what
truly two different stories or if I'm saying the same thing about both people. And
right.
Just a game of telephone kind of ruined the accuracy. But
still,
yeah,
weird.
I don't understand. And they're both in white, except one got a rose. Also, like, LOL to the lady in white, who apparently, like, no one needs to remember that she got a rose.
Yeah, wow.
The lady in red is said to be in the churchyard. She's seen there most often walking around. And some lore says that she's looking for her kid. Oh. For, like, I guess she had a stillborn child. And so they say that she's looking for her kid.
Oh, no.
But the lady in white, the one that's seen inside, she has not only been seen on the church property, but she's also been seen on other properties of the Daring. So of the Daring family.
Oh, weird. Okay.
So apparently this church, there's rumors that there was once a secret passageway or a secret tunnel that led to one of the Daring's manors.
Excuse and me. So, how fucking cool is that?
I know. I know. So
and the ghost can travel the path, the secret path.
That's
holy
like the,
shit.
That's like the coolest part of it all.
That is.
That like apparently she's like, I'm bored of the church today, but luckily like this building and this building are connected via tunnel, so I have access
how
to it.
How fucking cool is that?
So Lady in White is doing a lot better than Lady in Red. And
she's still trying to get out of the last lead coffin, probably. She's like, I'm almost there.
The ultimate escape, yeah. And so the Lady in White, she gets a change of scenery from time to time. And wow. She's been seen at the Surrenden Daring Manor, which I guess has now burnt down. But up until it burnt down, people were seeing her in the library. There was one time where a guy named Walter Winans, who apparently was like a multi-Olympic medalist, fun fact.
Whoa.
He was visiting the Surrenden Daring Manor, and he was walking through the halls and saw the Lady in White standing there. Apparently, so Walter Winans, his Olympic medals came from shooting. So I don't know if he was like proud or something, and he was like, it sounds to me like he was walking around in the halls with his rifle for no reason. I don't know if he was like carrying it around hoping someone would stop and ask him what was up, and then he'd be like, oh, I'm an Olympian.
Can't
I don't know what
see
the deal
all the medals around my neck that I also wear everywhere I go.
Right. Or he was like alone in the house and like for protection was carrying a gun around in the house. I don't understand, but he saw the Lady in White in the library. He freaked out and shot her because there was an intruder, which like, so again, why were you carrying a gun at all? And also clearly you were in a state where you were looking to shoot something.
Primed. What if it had just been like some lady who was like, oh, I'm just in the library looking at some books, and you just,
which was
like,
the librarian.
Yeah. Well, you like, shot her.
So I'm like, okay, you're an Olympic medal card holding gun shooter, but also like you clearly like
just a little like trigger happy, you know?
Yeah, that's exactly it. Your instincts like were not like diffused at all. Like
no,
you were
like, maybe you need to remember you're not at the Olympic games anymore. Yeah.
Anyway, thank God this was a ghost that he shot at. Let's thank just be God. Happy for that. I hope he had a little like nerve to him later where he went, oh my God, I literally just shot
I hope he had a moment of self-reflection.
Like,
yeah.
Was like, that his first person? Or like maybe he heard sounds downstairs and he was freaking out, so he got a gun to go confront
somebody.
That's the other
thing, like maybe he heard an intruder and went, right. But still, I'm like, it's not even your house. Like, it's, you're staying there, right? Like, it's not like he lived there.
I like to think if I had a gun and if someone broke into the house, I would still hesitate with, like, my morals of, like, am I prepared to shoot a person?
I'd at least
even
be like,
if it's for self-defense.
Who are you? What are you doing here? Yeah.
Yeah. So, anyway, I don't know, but it was just weird that the story gives no context. They're like, oh yeah, he was walking in the halls with his gun, and then he sees the Lady in White, and then he shoots her, and I'm like, whoa, like,
yeah,
maybe
but don't worry, he had an Olympic gold medal. What?
Yeah.
He had
two, actually.
That explains it.
So anyway, because she was a ghost, the bullet went right through her, and then she vanished. Fair enough. If I were her, yeah. I'd vanish too. So people think that the Lady in White might have been a baroness. Some say that she might be related to the Lady in Red, that they might be sisters or mother-daughter or something. There's a lot of rumors about who they are and how they got there, but that's what you need to know about them. The next place is called the Greystones, but apparently that name was changed from the Rectory Cottage, so now it's the Greystones.
Okay.
This house has been around since 1863, and a monk lived there. and he is now known to haunt the trees like a little monkey.
I know, that's what I was thinking. I was like, it's a great play on words there, Em. You didn't even do it on purpose.
Sometimes the comedy just writes itself. So apparently this monk fell in love with a neighbor's daughter. And
are they allowed to do that?
I don't think so. I think this was just like kind of like a rogue monk. I guess it depends on
a rogue monk in the trees. Oh my God, help. That sounds terrifying.
Apparently he fell in love with the neighbor's daughter, who I guess fell in love with him too. And so they would regularly walk the paths together and talk. And I guess maybe that was all they were allowed to do. I don't know.
Aww.
So at the same time that he was falling in love with the neighbor's daughter, who was falling in love with him, this monk had it going on because there was a woman nearby who was also pining after him.
This must have been one hot tree monk.
He was like just, he was a monk hunk.
One hot tree.
Did you hear it? A monk hunk?
Yeah, okay. He's one hunk of a monk. How about that? Ah!
Don't you say, his hunky monkey, if you will. Also, fun fact, I'm pretty sure Hunky Monkey was the name that Ben and Jerry's came out with when like gay marriage became like a thing, like because they have Chunky Monkey.
Yeah, no, yeah.
I think was it Hunky Monkey that
well,
they
Chunky
made?
Chunky Monkey's my favorite flavor of Ben and Jerry's, so I don't know.
They did some play on of but Chunky Monkey fun. As like a celebration. Oh no, it was Chubby Hubby. Chubby Hubby. So
I like
anyway.
Hunky Monkey though. Apparently I that's know. A type of a strain of Kush.
Oh. So. Well, I'm glad someone's using the rhyme. So, anyway, so this other woman happened to be in love with him. She Uh-oh. Is known as a separate ghost. So, she is known as the Lady of Rose Court. And sometimes, on other websites, she was known as the Tudor Woman.
Tudor? Like Tudor?
Tudor, oh. Yeah. I just said it weird. Tudor Woman. So, the Lady of Rose Court and Tudor Woman are the same person.
Oh, okay.
But apparently people will see a ghost of the monk walking on the same path as the woman, or walking on the same path that he used to go on with the woman he was in love with. People will hear a man and a woman talking and laughing together. People will just see like his apparition floating by. But then as for the Lady of Rose Court, Tudor Woman, who never got the chance, the third wheel. Apparently she is also a ghost, but she died from, I guess, a broken heart of never getting to be with the monk. And so,
oh my,
she poisoned herself.
She
either made herself a drink out of poisonous berries juice, or she was just straight up eating the poisonous berries. Like, didn't take the other step of making the drink. She just ate them.
So she didn't die of a broken heart. She died by suicide.
The broken heart is what led to the official death.
Sorry,
so, yeah.
I literally just, like, choked on my own.
Are you also eating some poisonous berry juice
right
now?
I might be. It feels a little bit like it.
So, apparently, when she died, she couldn't take the pain, ate these berries.
Awful.
She was looking out the window. She was found as if she had been looking out the window and watching them walk around.
Oh, that's
a la
so dark.
Taylor Swift's You Belong With Me.
Seriously, like, so dark. Yeah.
So they say she died around 4 or 5 in the afternoon, which is, how do you say that? 4 or 5? Do you say, is 4 afternoon for you? Or like when does night begin for you?
I would say like 4 or 5 to me is still afternoon. I feel like maybe 5 to 6, 6 to 7 is evening. I don't know.
To me, 4 is afternoon and 5 is night.
Night? Not even like evening?
Obviously, I divvy things up by meals. And by 5, it's appropriate to have dinner. So I think of it as night.
Like, I agree that, well, 5 usually to me is happy hour. So it's like pre-dinner.
Yeah. You know? Okay. That's fair. Yeah. At 4 o'clock, I say good afternoon. And at 5, I would say like good evening, maybe, instead of good night. What's the difference between evening and night?
That's what I said. Evening.
Did you? I was not listening. Sorry.
I know.
Okay, I would agree then. I would say evening, yeah.
Evening, yeah.
So anyway, 4 in the afternoon to 5 in the evening, that's when they say that she died. And so now only in that like span of time will she ever haunt the area, which I love that she's like on the clock. And like and she only has like a 2-hour work week. So good for
her. Kind of nice.
Girl boss.
Yeah.
From 4 to 5, you can hear a woman's voice. You can see objects moving. And you can also hear the sound of dogs every now and then. Because I guess that was also the time when the dogs would get fed.
Aww.
So you can hear dogs or you can hear her. There's also the watercress lady. She has apparently, when she was alive, she liked to go to the stream and collect watercress to sell to the village. And she was known as my least favorite compliment, eccentric. it's like
that and quirky. I'm like, ugh, quirky.
Quirky, I understand why it comes off a little gross, but I don't have as big of a problem with it as eccentric, just because I don't have my like childhood trauma from being called eccentric by every friend's parent. So every time I hear eccentric now, I'm like, I get it. I'm loud and annoying. I feel
like eccentric is always like rich old people. That's so weird.
Oh, eccentric to me means quirky.
I mean, I think they're similar, but I feel like I've always heard like, oh, he was an eccentric like art collector with.
Interesting. I've also heard it that way. I think I just get sensitive about it and I hear like quirky in a bad way.
The word like, I got voted by my classmates in third grade was weird. So,
you know,
I don't know. They all mean the same thing to me. When
really, it was just always crazy. 444. So the watercress lady, she liked to end her days, as we all do, sitting on the bridge, drinking gin and smoking her pipe.
Oh, hell yeah.
I feel like she had some cool stories.
I'm into that.
One night, though, she fell asleep doing this, and the gin poured onto her clothes, and the pipe caught her shirt on fire, and she she woke up to being burned alive.
What? Holy shit.
Yeah, that was a fast left turn. Sorry. Yeah,
wow, that's horrible.
So now by the bridge, it's Pinnock Bridge, people see an apparition of someone that apparently sometimes glows pink.
Oh, jeez.
Sometimes she's a mist that's still smoking her pipe and sitting by the bridge. And sometimes this was only a one reference, but okay. She's still on fire.
See, I like the idea that she's still just smoking her pipe and drinking. Like, she just is enjoying the good times, you know, but the fire.
I will say that the fire thing I only saw on one website. The is often seen as a mist sitting on the bridge still smoking a pipe was like, for sure, the more...
Let's hope for that. I hope for that for her.
It seems to be the more common lore. So, fingers crossed that's what she's up to. There's also the forest in Pluckley called Daring Wood, because it's on the Daring property.
Love it.
Although it's also known as Screaming Wood because of all of the screams people hear in here.
Why?
It's just a lot of screaming.
No.
One of the screams is known to be so loud and unexpected that birds will panic and fly away.
Oh, geez. And these poor birds are like, I was just trying to live my life. This person keeps screaming at random intervals.
There's a TikTok trend right now where you get like, it's usually, I'm in heteronormative terms, what seems like women tricking their boyfriends. But there's a TikTok trend right now where you wait until they're really concentrated on something and then out of nowhere play... the song I Feel Good, but it starts with that guy going, ow, I feel good.
Yeah.
But you like start on the ow when they're not expecting it and just watching them freak out. I imagine that's how the birds feel right now. And if this were like still happening in real time, someone's making a TikTok of it while the birds fly away.
These
you know?
Poor birds. Always the victims.
So in the forest, there's one area called the Fright Corner.
Oh, no.
Because apparently there people will see the apparition of a dead body leaning against the tree with a sword stabbed through him.
What?
So he's known as the Highwayman.
Dear God.
One reference calls him Robert Du Bois, but I didn't hear that. Robert Du Bois, not like the boy.
Du Bois.
Not like the baby. So Robert Du Bois. But I don't know if that's his real name or fake name or whatever, but he's known also as the Highwayman. Him and the Watercress Lady are the oldest ghost lore in Pluckley, apparently. But so the Highwayman, people have seen him in the woods, which is interesting that he's not called like the Woodsman. Why is he called the Highwayman? I don't get it.
Maybe he was traveling through.
Maybe he traveled a lot, yeah. The story has multiple versions, but basically it comes down to he was being chased in the woods either by police or like thieves or something, and they either cornered him, pinned him against the tree and stabbed him with a sword, or while being chased he hid inside the tree and they stabbed through the tree into him.
Oh god, either way, why? No,
either way, apparently they still see an apparition of him, like They say you still see an apparition of him with a sword through his chest in the
woods.
There's also a second ghost in the woods who was a schoolmaster. His name might have been Henry Turf, and he died by suicide in the woods. Apparently, the story goes that he had PTSD after World War I, and he hanged himself and is his apparition is still seen in the trees.
Oh, no.
There is also a colonel from Pluckley who died the same way, and he is said to still walk on the property. They still see him walking back and forth where he died. Even though all the trees are gone, the property looks completely different. You still see this man walking back and forth in the area where he died.
Oh, wow.
There's also a farm that is now actually a hotel. It's been around since 1406. And wow. This farm slash hotel is where a bunch of prisoners of war were kept during the Napoleonic Wars. It had some significance during the Civil War, during World War II. So just a lot of history there. Although it is England, you know, it's all history. So the current owners somehow didn't know that it was haunted when they bought the place. I don't know how you can live in the UK and just be like, not a lick of ghosts here. on their first day of owning the property, though, they heard a voice in the dairy part of the farm. And the voice said, "I will." And so the guy was like, "That's weird." So he mentioned it to his neighbor. The neighbor showed him a newspaper clipping that one of the previous farmers that lived there shot himself in that same spot. And his last words were, "I will do it." So.
Oh, God. It's weird. Ugh, goose cam.
Yeah.
Ugh.
The same ghost is apparently still seen walking the property. Sometimes he's even in the hotel, I guess. Which I love when they are still running with their own blueprint of things, but like now they're in weird places. Like, why are you in the hotel?
They walk straight through the refrigerator and you're like, they're like, "That's, this is the commode. I'm trying to pee."
Allegedly in this hotel, I'm sure there's a million other ghost stories of like the lights going on and off, the electronics messing up, doors opening. But the coolest haunt on this property, apparently if you use the wrong light bulb in a socket, the light bulb will take itself out, and then by the next day, it'll be on the other side of the room.
What? I like that they don't shatter it.
But yeah, they don't shatter it, and the ghost is clearly a maintenance man who's like, "Get that bullshit light bulb away from me. Like, that's not where this goes."
Incandescent all the way, man.
Right. There's also the bakery, where apparently people hear footsteps in the empty rooms. There are cold spots. People hear the sounds of a horse and carriage being driven towards the building. And what's cool about the horse and carriage is that this isn't the only place that people have encountered this horse-drawn carriage ghost. It's been like all over Pluckley. Most of it has been at a place called Maltman's Hill. But one person saw the carriage with lights coming from the inside. Another said that it passed them on a back road one night. One person said that they heard hooves on the cobblestone, even though the road wasn't cobblestone anymore. They heard hooves on cobblestone.
Wow, I love that. That's cool.
And apparently they heard it until it was so loud that you thought the horse had to be next to you and then disappeared.
That's scary. And
the creepiest one is one person even reported hearing the sound of the carriage and horses from inside their car. Like the sound was in their car.
Ugh.
Which feels intentional. That's weird. And then there's a guy called the Miller. And he was actually Richard Buss, who went by Dickie Buss. And apparently there's like a road named after him and all this now. But Dickie Buss, his ghost is called the Miller because his solid black apparition is seen at the abandoned windmill that he used to work at. And so the windmill Miller. So apparently this windmill was near the Pinnox, which sounds like it's also near the bridge where the Watercress Lady is. But at this windmill, you will see an apparition only right before a storm comes through. And apparently the reason he haunts this place is because he was the last miller at this windmill before it got destroyed by a lightning storm. So now when there's a new lightning storm, it's almost like he's there to warn you a storm's coming in.
Oh, no.
And then there is the screaming clay man who apparently he did like brick work in the area, and either he fell into the clay pit
and
a bunch of the clay bricks fell onto him and he died from like getting trampled by the bricks, I guess. So people say that you can still hear his screams even though they're disembodied. You don't know where they're coming from.
Oh, God.
Then there's the former hunting lodge called the Daring Arms, and this is haunted by a lady wearing a bonnet. Apparently she's so solid and looks so real that people mistake her as a customer. And the final place is the Blacksmith's Forge Tea Room, which apparently for a while was called the Blacksmith's Arms. It was also called the Spectre's Arms and the Ghost Arms just because of how haunted it is. It has three spirits there. One is a cavalier who is heard and apparently sometimes even seen pacing upstairs in different rooms. There is a maid and a coachman who are both seen by the fire at the bar. Wow. Isn't that cool?
It's a party.
It's a party. One employee saw, like, I guess a bunch of mugs were hanging and saw them, like, move as if someone ran their finger across them. Another employee heard the door open and heard what sounded like someone seating themselves. And so when they went out to take their order, nobody was there, but the chairs had moved.
Ooh.
Apparently that's, I guess, pretty common that, like, it sounds like people are in a room when you're not there. Anyway, two fun facts. In the area, there's the Kent and Sussex Tea and Coffee Company, and they have some tea that are named after the ghosts at their tea house.
That's very on brand.
And
for us.
For us. And just a fun fact, Pluckley's population is a little over 1,000, and with the amount of ghosts that there are, that means that the ghost-to-human ratio is 1 for every 89 humans.
Wait, that's amazing.
So... anyway, that is the story of the ghost.
I want the screaming clay man as my ghost, please. Thank you.
You know, he seems like if he's just screaming, I feel bad for how he went, but like if he's just screaming, that feels like a lot less effort in having to like maintain a ghost in your home, you know?
That's true. Although I guess it would be very, like it would never get like easy. You'd always be frightened, I feel like, or like alarmed.
You'd always be on edge, like at any moment there's gonna be a massive
like
scream.
Especially if you're a podcaster, you're like, I'm really trying to work here, you know?
Or maybe I just want the monk who's like just walking around outside and the hunky monkey. Yeah,
I want the dog ghost. Call it. I'm calling it.
Oh, sorry. Wait, okay,
sorry, that's... everybody, calling it.
That's fair. Actually, you know what? You can have it because apparently you only hear him when it was feeding time. So, like,
that's fine.
That's a loud dog.
I'll take it. I'll take the dog. No, the dog in the church or whatever. The dog in the church that they played with.
Damn, I'm
jealous of
you.
You already forgot about him. No, I'm playing with him.
Okay.
But I do have a question.
Yeah.
Which is, I know that the tree monk, the ghostly tree monk, yeah, he haunts the trees. It sounds like a Dr. Seuss book, but he haunts the trees. But why does he haunt the trees? I thought he just, like, walks the path. Or is that what they mean?
I guess that's what they mean.
Like, between the trees or something?
I think they just kind of, like, in the wooded area or in the land.
I thought we were going, like, oh, he loved this girl, and then every time somebody saw them, he would, like, climb up the tree and hide or something.
I was thinking, like, Peeping Tom status, but ooh, then, like... why else are you up there? And like, also, like, go to heaven or something. Like,
go to heaven. Climb his tree and climb up to heaven. Yeah,
maybe
here.
He's trying to get to heaven. I don't know.
Maybe.
But yeah, I think when they say, like, I think it's just like haunt the, like,
among
haunt
the
land.
Trees.
Among
I
the
see.
Trees.
Got
like,
it, got it, got it.
Who's
it.
Among the trees in Dr. Seuss? Was that Horton?
No, that's the Lorax.
The Lorax. He's just the Lorax, you know?
He's just the same as the Lorax. It's fine.
Yeah, he speaks for the trees. So
sort of like
go.
A religious Lorax.
Yeah. He's a... No, I can't come up with anything. I was going to try to come up with another pun. I couldn't think of things that sound like Lorax.
Puns, I think.
Okay. Leave that to Seuss.
Leave that to the professionals.
Hey, we have anxiety. Did you know that?
Oh my god, I forgot, but now I remember.
Yeah, and now we're anxious again. Uh-oh. So if you happen to be someone who deals with anxiety or depression or just general anything interfering with your happiness or something preventing you from your goals, luckily BetterHelp is here to assess your needs and match you with your own licensed professional therapist.
Yeah, it's great. You can start communicating with them in under 48 hours. They have a broad range of expertise available, which may not even be available locally to you. And the service is available for clients worldwide. So basically what you do is you log into your account, send a message to your counselor, and then you'll get timely and thoughtful responses. Plus, you can schedule weekly video or phone sessions so you don't ever have to sit in an uncomfortable and maybe germ-filled waiting room as with traditional therapy.
And it's more affordable than traditional mm-hmm. offline counseling, and financial aid is available. BetterHelp wants you to start living a happier life today. In fact, so many people have been using BetterHelp that they are recruiting additional counselors in all 50 states.
This podcast is sponsored by BetterHelp, and That's Why We Drink listeners get 10% off their first month at betterhelp.com/drink.
BetterHelp.com/drink. That's better, H-E-L-P, and join the over 1 million people who have taken charge of their mental health with the help of an experienced professional.
According to Forbes, gyms, nail salons, hotels, mom-and-pop stores, and even more are set to go on an epic hiring spree in the coming months. So heads up, if you're looking for a gig to meet the pent-up demand for all of these services, hello, that's where ZipRecruiter comes in, baby.
When you post a job on ZipRecruiter, they send your job to over 100 top job sites, and they give you access to their network of millions of job seekers. And ZipRecruiter's matching technology scans resumes to find qualified candidates for your open roles and proactively presents them to you.
That's right. So they turn to ZipRecruiter to fill the roles fast, and you can try it for free now at ziprecruiter.com/drink. You can easily review recommended candidates and invite your top choices to apply for your job, which encourages them to apply faster. That's how we found Eva. We were like, hey, you, come here, please.
the same day that we put out our posting was the day that we manifested Eva into our world.
Which is apparently a statistic, because it's so effective that 4 out of 5 employers who post on ZipRecruiter get a quality candidate within the first day. We made it into that statistic. It's kind of great.
And right now you can try ZipRecruiter for free at this exclusive web address, ziprecruiter.com/drink.
That's ziprecruiter.com/drink. Just go to ziprecruiter.com/drink. ZipRecruiter, the smartest way to hire.
Okay, so there's this, like, crazy thing going on in our house, which, like, maybe it's not crazy. Maybe I'm crazy. I was just telling Allison about it. It's freaking me out, though, that we've been getting a lot of flies recently, which, like, it's summer. Like, I get things are coming in through the apartment. But, like, not, like, a gross amount of flies, but, like, just definitely more flies than normal. Like, I don't know, 3 a week. Like, not a big deal. But in the last couple weeks, you know how, like, when flies die, they'll, like, just kind of, like, fall wherever they are and land on the floor?
Right. Or, like, the windowsill or something.
Yeah. These, every, like, enough that I'm noticing. So it's got to be, like, a decent-sized number, at least compared to what I'm used to in terms of flies around here. Every fly I have found in the last couple, I would say at least a week, the body of the fly is completely intact, but they don't drop. They die and just stay on the wall, or like stick on the furniture, or it's really weird. And I feel like I've never seen that with flies before. Maybe I'm just noticing it for the first time, but I feel like they're turning into like little statues
and like just freezing in place, like freezing wherever they were standing. Ew.
Yeah, it's super weird, because there's been like a bunch of times I've like tried to come at them with the fly swatter and they didn't react, and then I kind of just did like a hello, like, are you gonna fight me on this? And
aren't just, you playing?
And then by the time when I hit them, like, they through the fly swatter, they feel like hardened, like they dried up. It's really weird, and it's really freaking me out. But anytime I've seen a fly now,
did
I just,
you just
saw
see one.
I did, and I went into RJ's room and
put it in there.
No, I went to go get a coaster, but on his bed I saw a fly sitting there, and I was like, I'm going to just wave and see if this fly even goes anywhere. And it's just sitting on, like, on the side, like, on a part of his, like, bed frame where he should have fallen once he died.
Wait a second. Did you just have the place exterminated? It's probably because of that.
So I would like to think that that's probably what this one fly instance was. But, like, this has been happening since before we got the exterminator. It's really weird. It's really weird. Anyway.
Do you have a carbon monoxide detector? I'm, like, freaked out now.
Oh, I am, too. I was like, is this, like,
climate change?
It's like, are they drying out because of the heat or something?
What if this was the one thing that, like, finally you were like, climate change has gone too far? 2 dead flies on my sofa.
Anyway, that is such a stupid thing to bring up, but
it is freaky. It's like a Amityville, tiny little minuscule Amityville going on.
They're just turning into little figurines. It's so gross. Ugh. Anyway,
statuettes. Anyway. Yikes. Well, what a horrific interlude. Thank you, Em.
We're going to keep that in the show. Great.
I don't know. Probably, because I don't feel like cutting it out. And I can already tell in the future. Also, speaking of, like, things we're not cutting out, we never mentioned that our merch is going on sale. So, oops.
Oh, my gosh. We never okay. Yeah. So, fun fact. Let's talk about it.
Because I know a lot of you, like, to skip the intro. Okay, we know you do that. It's very rude.
So we actually caught you prime so time we, yeah, right here.
We're actually just gonna spring this on you in the middle of the show. We are putting our so our merch. We're doing a deep clean of our merch. Let's put it that way.
That's a good way. A spring cleaning, but really like a prepping for the fall, like an early Halloween special.
Of our prime time. We're preparing for like our prime, which is the mm-hmm. fall, the autumnal time. And so we're getting, otherwise known as the fall. And we're getting rid of all our old merch. And so we're putting it on sale, I think, on Tuesday? I don't know, early this week.
Tuesday or Wednesday. If you're listening to this when this comes out, we'll be posting about it online. And
it'll come up any day now.
But it's going to be, like, I think up to 50% off on merch.
Yeah,
on
I think
merch.
So. 50% off. And it's limited time because it's just whatever's left. So,
yeah.
You know, and then we're going to try to overhaul, like, just come up with some fun new stuff to take the place of the old merch. So,
Exactamundo.
Last chance.
If you've been looking at some stuff and you're like, oh, I wish it were 50% off. Well, guess what? It's about to be.
So. We heard your prayers. We're here to deliver.
We heard your cries. All right. Well, tell me your story. But before you do, I'm going to crack my little drink open.
Oh, my gosh. Great idea. I have my little iced coffee.
That wasn't as fun as I wanted
to. That didn't quite work like it used to. No. You know, yesterday, I totally forgot. I actually brought this little, remember I was drinking this San Pellegrino? I brought it up close so that I could crack it open, and then I like did it before we recorded it, and I was like, that was the whole point.
Well, excuse my weird faces, because I've never had this before. It was a surprise from Allison, and I don't know if I'm going to like it.
Is it a tea java?
No, but it looks like that. Actually, I think it's probably from the same company, but they don't. It just says tea on it.
Okay, I was like, you're not going to like it because it's coffee.
No, it was a good call on her end because it does sound like something I would like, but I'm a little scared. It's Earl Grey tea. Okay, we're cool with that.
Wait,
and it's
we can't
also,
see it.
Oh, I wasn't here.
Oh, sorry. I thought you were trying to show it. Oh, just kidding. It's all blurry.
Yeah. It's Earl Grey tea, but it also is blood orange infused. Sounds good, but I'm always scared to try new things. So sorry if my face is a little wild.
you're afraid of change.
I really am.
Meanwhile, anyway. Like anything with a weird combination, put it in my mouth. I'll eat it.
If it's sardines and sadness, and I want that shit.
A sardine and sadness sandwich. That's
and
my dream.
Dried
meal.
Fly sculptures.
The
I
next
want those.
Time somebody says, like, do you have any pregnancy cravings? I'd be like, sardines and sadness sandwich, please. It's just two, actually, while we're at it. One to go.
Yeah. All right. So tell me your village story, my little village person.
I would be happy to. Sorry, my dog's now barking.
Or it could be the ghost. Who knows?
It could be my new ghost dog that I've just adopted.
Here, I'm going to try this for everyone since we're not doing anything. Ooh.
You don't like. Oh, you do like? You're doing you're doing a kombucha face.
I think by the end of this, I will really enjoy it.
Really? But, like, okay.
But currently, I do not like it. No. I'm going to have to wean myself into the enjoyment part of it.
Oh, interesting. Okay. Well,
It's better than the second. Yeah, okay. We're gonna get into it. By the end, it'll be my favorite drink I've ever had. So
you're gonna like ask them to send you another care package and a blanket, and like,
I'll just be like, "Don't watch my first reaction to it."
Yeah, we're gonna just ignore that part. It's irrelevant.
It's weird. It's like a creamsicle and tea had a baby. It's very odd. Anyway.
Oh, that is odd. I can't actually picture what that would taste like. I don't know.
Yeah, I'm really starting to dig it all of a sudden. Okay.
Oh, good. All right. Well, I do, as your little village person, have a creepy village story for you, which is just such a strange little coincidence. Quinky dink. So this is in Mexico. We are near the city of Ciudad Victoria. Oh, I guess I should tell you what it's called. So this is the story of Magdalena Solís, a.k.a. the High Priestess of Blood. Dun, dun, dun.
Wait, the High Priestess of Blood?
Yeah.
Oh, my God. Oh, that's so fun. I mean, it's probably not.
It's so fun. It's not, but, you know, it is in theory.
I think in entertainment value, the story itself will be one I want to listen to.
Oh, it's a stunner, I will say. It's okay. Quite a tale.
I mean, you have to do a lot of damage to get that kind of name. So,
yeah, it doesn't come easily, I would imagine, that kind of a name. You have to earn it, and she mm-hmm. did. So we're in Mexico, near the mm-hmm. city of Ciudad Victoria in Tamaulipas. And we're in a smaller village, so kind of like your Kent degrees of separation, were in an even smaller village nearby, or in the area called Yerba Buena. Yerba Buena. And I want to apologize. There are a lot of terms that I'm going to probably butcher. This is a lot of Spanish, Mexican Spanish specifically. I'm going to probably sound like a real tool, and I apologize, but I'm going to try.
A for effort.
Thank you. Maybe B for effort. We'll see.
Yerba Buena.
Yes.
Okay.
So this is 1962. So ways back. And the population of this tiny little town, village, if you will, is 50 people. Very small. There's no access to electricity, no telephones, completely isolated village. And it's actually technically called an ejido, which... in Mexico translates to a sort of communal farm. Oh. So it's sort of like 20 families are living there, and they're all kind of farming and sustaining themselves in this like little town.
It is like a little commune so far.
Yeah, it is sort of like a little commune. Not in like the hippie sense necessarily, but like in the government-funded like farm
team,
town.
The team building.
The team building. Yeah. Yes. So charming. So, in Yerba Buena, alongside the no electricity or telephones... Sorry, now there's somebody at the door.
It's like, don't worry, I scared him real good. And then you're going to say, that wasn't necessary, my friend.
This is why we put you in daycare.
How dare you?
He's like, do you know what that mailman would have done? No, what would he have done? Tell me. For once, tell me. Tell me what would have happened.
Tell me something I wouldn't have wanted to happen other than him approaching us with the mail.
And giving me food for you that I feed you, Gio. It's always like his food. Like, it's like being his fancy ass food being delivered. And I'm like, do you even realize, like, how your chewy box is here? What is wrong with you?
It feels like a kid, like, cussing out the pizza man even though he brought your dinner. It's like...
Yeah, it's like, go away! Go away! It's like, I'm trying to feed you! You don't even have to pay for it!
It's like, if I wasn't here, you'd find a way to complain about it too, so...
I know, exactly.
Riddle me that.
There's like, riddle me that, my friend. There's no winning. Okay, no, I apologize. Winning. The person has left. So, in Yerba Buena, alongside the no electricity or telephone situation, there also weren't any schools, any police, any churches. This is like, teeny tiny, like, off the grid.
Okay, like really just its own space and nothing else. Okay.
And so a lot of the people there were illiterate because they just never learned to read or write. Okay. There wasn't much schooling, and there wasn't really much to do at all except farm and sell any leftover produce to nearby towns. So
work
and farm and work some more.
Doesn't sound like a utopia kind of farmland to me, where I have to work, but okay, good
just
for them.
Just kind of day to day, living life, you know, same people, same.
Yeah.
So that gives you a good setup for what's going to happen. Now, the story gets pretty wild, so you need to bear with me and let me know if anything is unclear. Okay.
I fucking love when the stories come with a caveat of like, let me know when it gets a little too crazy.
Let me know when you're like, what the fuck are you talking about?
Let me know when I need to start again.
So please tell me if you need help understanding, because you might. Okay. So
perfect.
We're gonna start now.
Okay.
Two outsiders, they're a pair of brothers named Santos and Cayetano Hernandez. Okay. Hernandez, but I'm going to say Hernandez. That's just not going to work with my mouth for the rest of the show.
Okay.
Rode into Yerba Buena in 1962.
Okay.
And it's sort of like Pied Piper, where they show up and like just fuck shit up. Like, they just show up in this town and they're like, oh, look, a nice little self-sustaining, happy town, happy village. We're going to fucking like upend this place.
Oh, wow. Okay.
So they show up in 1962. They were known around Mexico to be scammers who spent the early 60s traveling around Mexico and conning people in small towns out of money and then moving on to their next target. So, like, sort of like this highway robbery kind of situation. They just travel along and, like, scam people.
Okay.
On the way. They get to Yerba Buena, and they thought it was going to be their easiest mission yet. It's a tiny-ass town. They're like, this will do.
Small potatoes.
Small bean and corn.
Tater tots.
Small tater tots. So they have the perfect ploy for this poor little town.
Oh, God. Okay.
They gather the villagers and proclaim to them that they are prophets sent by Inca gods.
Oh, God. Okay.
Who would soon return to Earth. And so this town needed to listen to them because they're here to spread the word of the Incan gods.
Wow. Okay. And I'm sure they... I see now why you said earlier that like, they're illiterate and things like that, so maybe they're not getting a lot of other...
Yeah, it's sort of like they're primed for an outsider to come in and to take advantage. To be manipulated.
Yeah, mm-hmm, they can't get their info in a lot of other places.
Exactly, and they're cut off from a lot of like other resources, so it's like they're not able to like call anyone and be like, what's going on here? Yeah, exactly. Uh-huh.
I'm already seeing the problems here.
Yeah, there's some big, big, big problems. And I mean, we end up at the High Priestess of Blood, so like it gets really out of control.
I forgot about her. Oh like, my god.
I know, she's like the Lady in Red, but like times a million. Like she puts the Lady in Red to shame because wow, she needs to be buried with a lot of lead coffins.
She's like every 80. Lady in Red we've ever discussed.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Like morphed into like the ultimate Red Lady. So they're like, these brothers show up and they're like, we're actually prophets from the Incan gods. And I'm going to tell you a little bit from Britannica, the encyclopedia, about the Incan Empire, just to give some idea. So okay. It was the largest empire in pre-Columbian America. And it, in common with other Andean cultures, the Inca left no written records, so their history is known chiefly from the oral tradition that has been preserved through the generations by official memorizers, and from the written records composed after the Spanish conquest. The Inca religion combined features of animism, fetishism, and the worship of nature gods, and the pantheon was headed by Inti, the sun god, Viracocha, a creator god and culture hero, and Apu Iyapu, the rain god.
Damn.
And under the empire, the Inca religion was a highly organized state religion. So it was like pretty much like required of people to follow this religion.
Okay.
And their rituals included elaborate forms of divination and the sacrifice of both animals and humans.
Oh, I was really on board up until that. Okay.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
Sounds pretty cool. Okay.
Everything's like, whoa. And then it's like, oh, whoa. Okay. Whoa, 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 whoa. Slow down. Yeah, so there's sacrifice, which always gets to, like, when Blaze and I were in, now it's me being the white person, like, when I was visiting, no, but when I, when we went to Belize, we saw these Mayan ruins, which was, like, the coolest thing I've ever done. But it was, like, so neat and, like, just so culturally fascinating. And they're like, and this right here, this platform is where they would, like, behead the sacrifice.
What?
And I'm wow. Oh good, this is, we're in the middle of this cave like a mile in, and they're like, anyway, here's where they would like sacrifice like, people.
I respect what you did, but also like that scares me too.
Like, yeah, I'm just like a little on edge now being in this cave like right. A mile from civilization. But I will say, obviously, this is not to discount it's like what
we did.
Like, you know, showing up and demolishing and decimating people is not any better than human sacrifice, to be clear.
No, like, we have, as Black Widow would say, some red in our ledger. And by some, I mean, like, we are basically the High Priestess of Blood. So.
We are the High Priestess of Blood.
You kidding me?
Like, we are the Lady
in Red. We
don't
get to fucking talk.
Exactly.
And just because something is different doesn't mean it is, like... completely near what we fucking did.
Completely. So I'm not saying like ew, you know, but it's like, oh my, like it just,
it's different.
It goes from like fascinating to like, oh, dark. It was pretty a little dark. So yeah, they did have human and animal sacrifice, and the religious institutions were destroyed by, well, not shockingly, by the Spanish conquerors' campaign against idolatry. So, you know, the Spanish came in and they're like, how dare you now follow our religion?
Right.
Classic move. So, yes. Just, you know, how history goes over and over and over again. So the brothers show up and they're like, okay, so those gods, right, like, all y'all know about them. We're actually prophets sent down by them. And we are also high priests of the, quote, powerful and exiled Inca gods. And in exchange for worship and tribute, the Inca gods will shower you, the people of Yerba Buena, with treasures.
Ooh.
If you respect us and, like, bow down to us and let us kind of show up and lead you, like, you will be treasure. You know, you'll be blessed by the gods.
This is no mistake. Like, you're going to have a... it's going to be a good call if you just do what we want.
You just gotta help out, and then you'll get everything you've ever dreamed of. So it wasn't that simple, because the brothers also told everyone that the Inca gods would be coming down to Earth soon, and any non-believers would be punished.
Okay.
Eternally punished, I should add. So, like, if you're not going to be on board, like, you're fucked, basically, is what they're saying.
Right.
Doesn't leave them much room, these poor, you know, folks who are just trying to mind their own business.
Yeah, It feels a lot like a lot of God-fearing people today of like, you better, precisely. Or else.
Or else, eternal punishment? Which yeah. one do you want to pick? Right. Everyone else is doing it. Would you rather yep. burn in hell forever? Exactly. So to fully convince the audience what they were saying was true, they used like obviously like big rhetoric and, you know, they used like manipulative language, but they also used sleight of hand tricks.
I was literally going to say, I was like, was there like a magic show?
Magic show, Emma.
Because I was thinking, not that religion was involved, but the Davenport brothers and the Fox sisters, mm-hmm. how they like would travel around and like really convince people. The second you said like, to prove or to show, I was like, oh, there's a visual here, and it's for sure magic.
100%. Okay. And again, like, these people have been isolated from any sort of other resources, so even though it's the 60s and there's, like, TV and, you know, phones, like, they don't have access to that, so they don't, necessarily understand that this is, like, just trickery.
Honestly, what a genius tool, though, to try to convince somebody that, mm-hmm. like, things, that, like, are not as they seem, you know?
Exactly. So, like, snake oil sellers, but of, like... gods. I don't know the quite vernacular for that, but
yeah,
it worked, let's just put it that way. So the villagers were like, holy shit, I guess we have to do what they say.
Yeah.
And they handed over food, money, resources. They treated the brothers like kings in order to get the treasure from the Incan gods that was promised to them. And when morale started to dip and skeptics were like, I don't know, this is a little fishy, the brothers made time to lead Incan rituals for the villagers to partake in. And now we remember the rituals that I listed earlier of like how far they could go. So, Well, first, the rituals just included like cannabis, animal sacrifices to the gods. Like they tried to make this look as like real and powerful as they could. And it got to the point where the villagers had handed over everything they had, everything. Whoa. Like they didn't have any resources left. And by this point, the brothers were on such a power trip that even though they were out of offerings, they were like, well, we can't leave now. Like, we own these people.
Right, yeah.
We've gotten far enough where, like, we can get whatever we want.
We've accidentally created ourselves a kingdom. Like,
we literally demanded that these people worship us, and, like, they do now. So yeah. We can't leave.
It's almost like it was too easy, which is really sad. Like,
it is. And it's like, when they leave elsewhere, what are they going to do, start over? Like, no, they're...
Yeah, why wouldn't you just stay at your established kingdom where you're seen as a god?
Kingdom.
Are you kidding?
Exactly. So what they did, this is just where it gets really fucked, Em.
Oh.
They began demanding more and more. The Yerba Buena community had essentially become slaves to the brothers. They could demand anything, and it would be done straight away to, like, the two kings that were there. It got to the point where the brothers started demanding the prettiest women, and by that I mean oftentimes girls, as young as 14, mm-hmm. to perform sexual acts on them.
Jesus.
And to the parents of the younger girls they preyed on, they said they were doing this because they needed to learn about sex from these, like, quote-unquote high priests.
And how lucky should prophets. They be that they've been chosen by literal gods.
Yes.
In like human messengers form.
Of the gods, right.
To be the ones to teach you on your sexual journey.
Think of all the blessings that will be bestowed upon you if you let this happen. Yeah.
Think of how attractive you'll be to your future suitor if they know that your first time was with a god, you know, or some bullshit you've like that.
Given yourself to the, Incan gods. So, precisely. According to a Medium article by Delaney Bartlett, once their sexual wants had been fulfilled, the brothers, this is so bad, would then sell the girls to traffickers who would send the girls to border towns and force them into sex work. So it wasn't even just like, you know, contained within this community. It was like once they got what they wanted, they were like, now we can make money off of them by sending them off because they're no longer virgins or whatever.
So like trafficking them.
Literally fully human trafficking. Yes. So
holy shit. Wow. You very quickly. You're right.
I'm telling you, from, like, it gets so fucking dark. Yeah.
Wow. It's okay.
That shit. So,
and also because like their thought process was like, well, now what? And like, it was like to like kill time or like get exactly. rid of evidence.
It's not like this was the plan all along. It's not like they went here for the purpose of trafficking. It was just like, well,
we need something to do. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Really fucked up. So they would send the girls to the border towns, force them into sex work. And the brothers didn't just demand sex from the young girls. They also demanded sex from basically anyone at any time. And the villagers just had to obey. And wow. After a time, their rituals began to include sex. Like, they would turn in these huge orgies. So this town is just going, like, upside down. Like, I feel like if you wow. visited the town and then, like, a year later you came back, you were like, what happened in the year that I was gone here? Things and do not look the same.
I imagine, well, I don't know if you know this, and I don't know if maybe I'm supposed to know this, and I'm just not reading the room, but is this a situation where people are happy to be doing this because they feel like they're fulfilling?
I don't think so.
Okay.
I think this is like they've been coerced and now it's like too late, if that makes sense.
Okay. So like even they know that something's up, they don't feel like they're blessed by a god.
I'm sure some people probably believed it, but I think there were enough people who were like, but like, what are you going to do? Like, okay. You're fucked because they're literally people. And
the one thing I cannot wait for you to cover one day, and like maybe even like if we ever do like a switch again, I get to cover a true crime or something, I still want you to do Warren Jeffs.
Oh, yeah, that's a good one.
And a lot of his followers, it's like kind of, it at one point was at least split down the middle, where half of them were like so grateful for all the weird sexual assignments they had versus like, or that like they had to sleep with this person versus this person. But then there were other people who were like, I'm married to someone I actually really love, and now I'm like forced into this, or like I'm gonna go to hell, and like my husband has to see me off and like watch me go be with somebody else. Like, it's really awful
and disgusting, like, stuff. That's a good point. And I feel like there's a blurred line between like you totally are skeptic and you're like, this person is fucking us over, and also like, I don't know if this is real, maybe it's real, but I have to go with it because everybody else is going with it and I don't want to be punished.
Yeah,
like,
there was also people yeah, like right down the middle of the road where they're like, they didn't feel violated, but they were like, well, you know, I'm just doing it because that's like my job, that's my duty, and
this is
like
what we do now, I guess.
And like not even like aware that like they have the say to not do it. Like, it's just really sad. So I don't know where these people stood.
I don't know. And I mean, you know, it's a really small town, 20 different families. What did I say? How many people? 50 people.
A lot. Or not a lot.
Not a lot. Yeah, 50 people. So I'm sure there was a mix. I imagine there would be a mix of both, of people who were like, I don't want to sell my child into sex trafficking, obviously.
Fair enough. I hopefully that didn't come off as too ignorant. I just know
no,
that,
I don't
like,
think so. I mean, you know, there's no way to know.
Someone probably felt like, my kid's the chosen one, and now they get to go do this work for their god. So
I mean, I'm sure that's how they played it, at least. So, you know, I don't know who believed what. But either way, they were in too deep, for lack of a better term.
Yeah.
And they didn't want to anger the brothers. They didn't want to disobey them. And just if this maybe adds to your question a little bit, they were also being fed psychoactive drugs regularly by the brothers.
That does answer some things.
So that could have tweaked maybe people's mindsets. Yeah.
Wow.
So it got to a point after 3 months of this where the villagers questioned why they still hadn't received any treasures, right? So they're thinking like, okay, yeah, we're on board. We've done everything you asked. Like, when do these supposed treasures from the Incan gods show up? But as soon as this thought even formed, the brothers had already planned for this because they were like, well, we want to make this last as long as possible. And they knew eventually, obviously, they'd be like, where's our prize?
Yeah.
So in order to keep this style of living, they had to go find a god or goddess to...
They already have two.
They're the prophets, Emethy. Of the gods.
Okay. Sorry. Right.
They're the high priests. Now they need a real deity to show up. So
I can't do it. Okay. Yeah.
They were like, we already found one. We have the perfect plan.
Okay.
They told the villagers it was time for them to speak to the Incan gods and promise that they would be back soon with their own goddess in hand. And this is where Magdalena Solís shows up. So Magdalena... Okay. Solís was an 18-year-old sex worker who had been forced into the trade at the age of 12 under the management of her brother.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah, a pimp named Eleazar. And alongside her earnings in the trade, apparently she had a keen interest in the paranormal. So she was fascinated by the occult, was working in the sex trade, was making extra cash through her work as a fortune teller and medium, and claimed to be able to channel the spirits of brujas, witches.
Okay.
The brothers found Magdalena in Monterey, which had become, unfortunately, the place where they would sell off the girls to sex trafficking.
Got it.
So that's where they were sending the girls from Yerba Buena, but then they went to that town to bring back Magdalena, who also lived there. And the brothers' plan was to convince a sex worker to return to them in the guise of her being an Incan goddess. So Magdalena was like, huh, this piques my interest, basically.
Yeah.
Why not?
Give me something to do.
Give me something to do. So I could bring my tarot cards, I guess. So
yeah.
She was on board and they headed back to Yerba Buena together. But they had to give, obviously, if they're bringing a deity to these people, they had to make it look as
legit convincing as possible.
Yeah. So when the brothers returned, they summoned everyone to a cave, which now is reminding me of my little Belizean cave, where they played out one of their normal rituals. But at one point, they created a smoke screen. And then when the smoke dissipated, seemingly by magic, there was Magdalena standing
where the smoke was.
They did like a smoky entrance, you know,
the old smoke and mirrors game.
The old literal smoke and mirrors, exactly. So she was there. It was the reincarnated Aztec goddess Cuatlicue, I think is how you say it.
Okay.
Accompanied by her brother. Like, okay, I guess he had to come too. Her, like, pimp, aka yeah. brother.
Like actually truly her brother came.
Oh yeah, her brother Eleazar, whom the other brothers called a high priest. So like,
yikes.
Her brother, aka the pimp who had sold her into sex slavery, was there too. I guess he probably demanded to come along, and he was called the high priest, and Magdalena was called Cuatlicue, which is like this Aztec goddess. I don't know why they didn't go with an Incan goddess. Weren't they supposed to be with, you know,
they didn't think it through. They didn't think
maybe they just didn't. I mean, it worked, so I guess whatever they did worked. I don't know. I don't know why I'm questioning it, but the villagers were just aghast. Like, they were in awe of this woman. They were like, this is our new queen. They doted on her from the second she appeared. She was given a ton of weed and peyote, which she was like from then on constantly on drugs. And she was just being like just offered, you know, constant weed.
So far it sounds like she kind of hit the lottery.
Yeah.
From where she was, now she's like just being treated like literal royalty.
Yeah.
And also, like, I'm still confused about like why her brother is there. Did like they have to make a deal with him?
I imagine since he was the one who was profiting off her working in the sex trade, that he probably was part of the package deal.
He was like, you can have her if I could. I can't imagine if he's like selling her to people and then someone comes up and says like, hey, can she be treated like royalty and not you?
And you're not part of it. Exactly.
I'm sure he was like,
a feeling he was part of the package, like either I come or nothing.
Yeah.
That's what I guess. I love that they're like, you can be a high priest like us, I guess.
Right.
Like,
yeah. All right. Sure.
So Magdalena was like living the high life, literally and figuratively. She was blissfully being like doted upon by the villagers. And soon it got to a point where I don't know if it was the drugs or just like the attention, but she literally began to believe herself that she was a goddess. Like, she took this on as like a very, very real persona. And I mean, good for you, I guess.
Yeah.
Girlfriend, it's get it.
Self-care, but like, confidence.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Maybe took it a little far, but that's okay. So she truly believed she was the Aztec goddess, Cuatlicue, who gave birth to the sun and the stars, reincarnated. So she started to believe, like,
wow.
You know, she believed that she was the reincarnate version of this goddess, and like, she deserved all of this praise. This wasn't a trick. This wasn't like smoke and mirrors. This
also, to be fair, she was like significantly spending like a lot of her time on drugs, though, right?
That's right. Yeah, exactly. Like peyote. Okay. Like
she was the high priestess.
Yes, okay, the high living the high life as the high priestess. Exactly. Yeah. So the brothers, like, I guess as much as they had prepared, they were not prepared for this level of delusion. Like, they prepared that she would be play along in their trick. But then they were like, oh, no, she actually believes this. Like, she doesn't totally remember that this is all, like, a big joke. Or, like, not a joke, but, like, a big trick.
Finally, it took this long into their plan since they came to Yerba Buena.
Yeah.
finally, the plan has gone too far for them.
Yeah, they suddenly it's out of control, right? Like, yeah. Of their control a little bit. Like, they brought in a third party, and what did they expect? I don't know. She took over. They didn't expect that she'd be so delusional to think she was actually a goddess, and they also didn't expect how much power the villagers would give this woman. Like, they literally were like, forget this high priest, these high priests. Like, this is our actual goddess. Like, she's the one that deserves all the attention.
Yeah, like, who are you now? Like, yeah, this woman is in charge aside. Of us.
Exactly. So the ritual orgies went on per usual, but now Magdalena was the one, you know, overseeing them. So, yikes. Remember, she's the high priestess of blood, so yikes. Okay.
Okay, got it. I see.
Yeah. She began ordering everyone to involve themselves in fetishism, incest, and bestiality.
Okay, I see.
Even got to the point, I'm sorry, where she was, she would encourage the SA of children.
Okay. Wow.
Bad. Which was already happening, but now, you know, now it's just more ritualized.
Like, now when the queen demands it.
The queen demands it. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And then she decided that was not far enough. Why not just, like, up the ante a little more? She had got an urge for blood. So she said to her followers that in accordance with Aztec mythology, blood was the only decent food for the gods.
Oh.
You know. And I want to be clear, this is like them fucking around. This is not me saying, like, this is the religious, this is the actual practice of Aztec.
This is what they were telling people for control.
Yes, this is what they took advantage of and tried to make. Exactly. So as part of the rituals, she got the villagers to cut themselves, and then she would collect their blood in a chalice, and then she would mix the blood with drugs and would drink it. And she told everyone this is how she was immortal. She would drink their blood mixed with, like, I don't know what drugs, but mixed with drugs, and that's how she was able to keep her immortality intact.
One, that number one, that would for sure convince me. I'd be like, this person's literally drinking everyone's combined blood in a cup, like,
out of a chalice.
If you're not a god, like, well, we're gonna find out real soon when you die from the biohazard. But
okay, very good point.
Like, I would, I mean, if someone said, I'll prove it here, like, where this is what I do now, I'd be like, damn, she must be a god. Or, like, even if she's not, I'm scared of her. Like, I, if
it's
that's
not
what
worth
she does,
questioning.
If that's what she does without even being asked, like, I don't want to know what she's capable of.
Yes. And number three, that sounds absolutely disgusting. I'm sorry. Like, I can't. Ooh. You drinking your blood orange over there, I'm just, your blood orange tea or whatever, I'm just like,
I'm the high priestess of blood orange, but that's
it. Exactly. Like, that's about the level that I could get to. No further. Ugh. Biohazard indeed. So whenever anyone questioned her practice, like, hey, so, like, why are we doing this again? Yeah. She would either set them on fire or beat them or threaten to have them killed.
Oh, my God. So why, like, was anyone questioning it? If someone's drinking blood, I would be like... First of all, whatever you say goes now out of fear. But also,
I
think, like,
I'd be like, if it's my blood, I'd be like, can you remind me again why I have to do this? I don't know.
She really wasn't getting sick from this?
No, I don't think so. I mean, people do shit like this, right? Like, people are, like, self-proclaimed vampires and shit.
I guess. I mean, I already wouldn't want to drink a different person's blood, not even my own blood, let alone a different person's blood. But then on top of that, like, you take a bunch of people's blood and mix it all together.
Oh, I don't know. I don't think she's mixing it together. I think she's just like
doing shots of different people's blood.
I think it's like, oh, as part of this ritual, this one person cuts their arm. I collect it in a chalice, mix it with drugs, and drink it.
It's still not good.
It's
still not
disgusting.
Good.
Trust me. Okay. Yeah, but I don't think it's like everybody has to, like, mix together their blood or anything.
That's what I thought was happening. Like, we were, like, it was like one big concoction.
Okay. I am so grossed out right now. Whatever it is, it's so foul. But if you question it, like, you were just set on fire, oops. So, nice work. Essentially, the Hernandez brothers were being just, like, shoved out of the picture at this point. Like, they just didn't matter.
If I brought someone in who was now drinking everybody's blood and they were like, you can go now, I'd be like, I was looking for a way out anyway, so.
Yeah, actually, we were already on the last train out of town. We're going to the next place, and next time we're not bringing an Incan god with us. We're going to do it ourselves. This got out of hand.
Ugh.
So Magdalena was, like, fully in charge. There is no doubt this operation had become, like, her cult, basically.
And one day she was confronted by two cult members who were essentially being treated as sex slaves, who were tired and broken and were like, we want out of here, please. Like, we're done. We just want to leave. We won't, you know, just let us leave. Well, they didn't get to leave. They were lynched later that day. Their blood was used in that evening's ritual. And
oh my God.
Now Magdalena had just like a full free card to murder people who were like in opposition to her. Like, how dare you question me? Were murdered and used for a ritual. So yeah, like people were not going to keep questioning her, basically. It's only been 6 weeks, by the way, since she got there. She's already sacrificed 4 people. She would cut the person, drink their blood, then cut out their hearts. And then stand over their bodies, quote, writhing in ecstasy.
Whoa.
Wow. Yeah, she's taking it too far.
She has really let the power go to her head.
Yes. I mean, this is the ultimate example of somebody letting the power go to their head. So, scene change here. All relevant, but just like split screen. This is what's happening somewhere else. A young man, a boy, 14 years old, Sebastian Guerrero, is out for a walk on a gorgeous May day. Suddenly he hears some screaming in the distance and he's like, what is that? So he sees flickering lights coming from the direction of the caves. So he goes to check it out. Y'all, if you're ever in this scenario, please do not go check it out. I feel like nothing good can come of this.
Yeah. Pretty,
Just
I don't know what somebody. He's about to see, but pretty naive for a darling bud of May.
Poor sweet buddy of May. He's like 14. So he goes to check it out. He gets closer and closer. He starts to smell incense and he enters one of the caves. Probably had no fucking clue what he was about to witness. I mean, this is the 60s again. This is not like ancient times where these things happened or were, like, you know, whatever. This
I really like can't. Whatever you're about to tell me is like insane. I can already tell.
He sees inside this cavern a group of naked people having sex with one another as a cup containing something of a deep red color is being passed around between everybody, and whatever is inside the glass is staining everyone's skin as they like drink it, and it's like spilling. And then he sees what is dispensing this lovely beverage that they're all partaking in, and he sees on top of an altar a man being chopped with an axe. I'm sorry. I just like M's face. Oh my God.
It's just nervous laughter. I mean, this
is horrible.
I'm
sweating so much. So he sees this man being chopped with an axe. His blood was being poured into glasses, and a woman was standing above him holding his heart in her hand. So this 14-year-old boy's like, uh-oh, this is not what I expected to see.
Are you kidding? His, like, tolerance for any information ever again just went plummeted.
I can't imagine if you're like 14, you're in the 60s, like out in a rural area, you've never probably even owned a TV, maybe you've seen like one episode. Whoa. Of like, what's one of those 60s shows that's really like cliche and silly,
the Brady Bunch or
the
something.
Brady Bunch, and he's like, this is my experience of the outside world. And then he walks into a fucking cave and sees
it was this. A literal Stephen King movie. It was like the beginning of It, and then it became the end of It.
He stepped into just like
a hellhole. Oh my. So he, okay. So just to clarify, just to like force myself to hear this again. So he ended up witnessing an orgy of people simultaneously having sex and drinking probably blood. Out of chalices, while behind them was another person being chopped with an axe to death, or was already dead, being chopped away while someone held his heart.
Yeah, and the blood in the chalice was being poured from his body that they were axing and then passing around, if that makes sense.
I was going to say, I was like, why are they still chopping at him if his heart's already out of his body?
They're gathering more blood.
Yeah, yeah. So they're just like...
refilling.
Wow, refilling.
The punch bowl.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's so fucked up.
Fucking terrible. So he's like probably, you know, changed forever. And
I am
too, right? Like this is enough to
traumatize me just fucking imagining
what did
it.
He do? I mean, I honestly honestly I would have been frozen in fear. I can't imagine being able to react. I would have just frozen.
I'm glad you asked, because he did exactly what we wouldn't do, which is that, so he ran away, understandably. Okay. But like, we're in the middle of nowhere. This kid has just like kind of wandered off. So he runs 15 miles to find the nearest person.
That's adrenaline.
I was going to say, that's when, you know, every time he starts to get tired, he reimagines it.
Yeah.
And it just fuels him all the way.
That kid will never wander away again. Like, just so.
Yeah. So he runs fucking 15 miles to the nearest village or the nearest town called Via Gran. And he runs to the desk of this police station he finds. And this poor kid is just like, I need to tell you what I just saw. He saw vampires, quote unquote, who are gluttonously drinking human blood. And awfully, terribly, the officers start laughing because they're like, okay, kid. And it's like, you don't even understand, officers, what the fuck truly, this kid just went through. Like,
yeah. As a 14, I'd be like, you just said it, but as a 14-year-old, I would be like, no, you don't fucking get it. Like
you piece of shit, you go look.
But also, like, it's so telling of his, like, youth that, I guess, he wasn't wrong by the definition, but for him to think they were, like, vampires.
Yes, he's
like,
how else do you describe that, right?
Like, I don't know what else to think of it.
He had 15 miles to come up with the vocabulary, and, like, vampires is what fits, I guess.
Ugh.
So one police officer named Luis Martinez finally is like, okay, I'll go back with you and we'll see what's going on. They drive, they decide to drive over to the cave, and they were never seen alive again. I know. It's terrible. It's like the last thing you want is for this.
Wait, Sebastian and the cop?
Yeah. Oh, okay. I know. It's awful. So Luis and Sebastian never returned, which obviously then the police are like, okay, wait, they went for this like mission and they never came back. So they're like, we need to go to Yerba Buena and check out what the hell is going on. So along with a contingent of the literal army, the Via Gran police headed to find Luis and Sebastian and see what was going on. They arrived at Yerba Buena and immediately discovered Luis and Sebastian's bodies near a farmhouse. They didn't realize at the time that this farmhouse is where Magdalena was living, but it was outside of her home. They flipped over the bodies to reveal that both of their hearts had been cut out.
Oh, no.
Yeah. So the Hernandez brothers, who are still there, even though, like, they don't matter anymore to anybody, they see that the feds have arrived, is basically where I was going.
Okay.
And they pull out their weapons and start shooting. And so the Yerba Buena villagers created a barricade in one of the caves. Santos Hernandez, one of the brothers, was shot by police along with many other members of the cult during this shootout. Magdalena and Eleazar were both found and arrested in a farmhouse. Both were in possession of a lot of drugs, which in my mind is the least of anyone's worries, but that's right. part of the scene. Cayetano Hernandez was also killed by a fellow cult member named Jesus Rubio, who apparently had been envious of the brothers' powers and had been wanting to become a high priest himself for a long time, but they never let him. So finally like, this is my moment.
And yeah, he was killed shooting my shot. Wow, that's... Yikes. Wow.
We don't know much about his story, but apparently he just was like, I want to be part of the club. Yeah, and they were like, no. And then he just got his revenge and killed one of them.
He had his own agenda, for sure.
Yeah.
Wow.
So in the caves, police found six other people who had been used as sexual sacrifices, which is a phrase I never wanted to hear in my life and now forced all of you to hear, and I apologize.
Oh my God.
It's sick. It makes me want to do a sign of the cross. I'm not even like Catholic anymore, but just like hearing like the horrors of, I don't know. Sometimes when I read these stories, I just...
I know.
I don't know. I don't know. Magdalena was sentenced to 50 years for the murders of Sebastian and Luis, although she had obviously killed
only 50
more people. Right.
And she was like, for sure, like the engine behind many other murders.
Yeah. And she was like R-wording like children and shit. You know what I mean? Like, there was a lot more darkness, but she got 50 years for the murders of Sebastian and Luis. Other villagers were called in to speak against her, but all of them refused to say anything that could be used against their goddess. Like, they were clearly fully brainwashed into this whole plan. And because of this, some of them even received 30-year sentences for being complicit in gang murder, which I'm sort of like, I think they were the victims here, but
it's always such a touchy subject because you definitely were threatened into this, but also you did do it.
But then partook. Yeah, it's like a very gray area, I feel like. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So if Magdalena was sentenced to 50 years, her release date would have been like very recently, like 2013. But I'm not sure if she ever got out. There's like doesn't seem to be much info. I feel like it would be good tabloid press if she were to get out. But
right.
I haven't seen anything. Also, who knows? Maybe she died in prison. Maybe she got more time, or maybe she just got out with no fanfare. Which imagine that 50 years later, getting out of prison and as being the high priestess. And now you're like,
I also wonder what her place in prison was like. Yeah. If she genuinely thought she was a queen and she was wondering why nobody around her would bow down. I wonder if she converted anybody to thinking she was a queen.
I wonder if that reality shattered or if she like continued it.
And I wonder if anyone who was threatened into the things that they did, if there was ever any unbrainwashing where they were able to realize the gravity of what
like,
they were doing.
Oh shit. Yeah. I imagine some people at least, but I don't know.
Mm.
So who knows? I mean, I'll keep an eye out. Maybe we'll find out what happened to her. But that is a story of the High Priestess of Blood of 1963. Not even that long ago. Thinking of, you know, Incan gods and sacrifices and all that.
Wow. So,
that's the story, Morning Glory.
I feel like that was your version of Madame LaLaurie.
Aha, interesting.
That was really slightly, dark.
Yeah, really dark. Similarly dark. I mean, I guess Madame...
A lot of torture.
Yeah, torture. Just like having people under your thumb and doing whatever you want to them. Ugh.
I mean, that was like that final scene of like in the cave. That feels like you just told me a scene from a horror movie trying to be scary.
Sounds like Da Vinci Code plus...
It's like Midsommar or some bullshit. Like
yes,
it was,
yes, 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 yes.
That it feels like the story can't be a real story. Like everything else, like... not trying to compare stories here in terms of like trauma or anything, but... The stories usually tell of like a home invasion or a kidnapping. It's like those are like rooted in real fear. But the one this one is like, I would have never even thought that that could be a legitimate concern. That's
I know. And the crazy thing, too, is like if that little boy hadn't been able to get to the police first and say, this is what I saw to all these officers and then get killed, because if he'd gotten killed right away, nothing would have happened. Nobody would have even probably realized, like, unless, you know, his parents happened to find where he ended up or, but
also like that's so, like, what a brave little kid, first of all, to like go back with the cop to say, this is what I saw.
Yes.
Are you kidding me? Like, wow. That's.
And just to end so tragically terrible.
Yeah. Wow. I really actually don't think I can process that. Fully wrap my head around that.
Mm-hmm.
I do think that is my version of a Madame LaLaurie story. It just so is like theatrically like horrific.
Theatrical, like, yes. It's just so over the top.
Yeah. Wow. Now I really don't know how to end this.
Anyway, as usual, here we are awkwardly backing out the door and saying, hope you had fun.
Yikes. I'm trying to think of a thing we can do. What's the size of your baby this week?
Size of my baby?
I'm desperate for like a way
to cantaloupe?
Like. It could be the size of anything, and I'd be happier than what I'm feeling right now.
Okay, let's go with cantaloupe or the volleyball from Top Gun or the Polly Pocket Adventure playset. Although I guess when this comes out, it'll be. The size of a Windows 95 box. You know those boxes that the CD-ROM came in?
Yeah. Wow. I totally forgot about that.
Let's see. Forrest Gump's box of chocolates.
Do we actually know what the size of his box of chocolates was?
No.
I feel like they really did give like such a vague detail of like what if... I mean...
Okay, wait. You're going to love the one after that. You'll know the size of this one. Week 34 is the Eggo waffle box from Stranger Things.
I literally made that.
I know. It's on here.
Wait. Ah. Oh, that very quickly, my dopamine levels are like on a roller coaster flexing around here.
Apparently, the box of chocolates is 17 inches long. So
that's so fun. Wow. So something I literally made is on
how
your
cool
app.
Is that? I was waiting. That's... I was like, it's movie props. I was like, eventually something's going to have to fit your.
Eventually something. Well, the guy who trained me and everything at ISS, he is the thing I give him claim to fame for is he was the one who made Wilson from Castaway, the volleyball. It's his handprint. And so
that is cool.
So I always wanted to, but I forgot. But before I left ISS, I wanted to get a volleyball and have him use his handprint and make me like a real Wilson.
A replica.
Yeah.
Dude, how cool is that? Well, this week it's a volleyball from Top Gun. I imagine it's the same size as the volleyball from Castaway, right? Like, I can't
imagine. It's probably a still standard volleyball, yeah.
Wilson's of any different size. I don't know. Yeah.
Well,
that's crazy. That's a really cool claim to fame, I have to
say.
Well,
please screenshot the Stranger Things Eggo box then.
I will.
Because that's, you know, I mean, it's literally the same size as every other Eggo box, to be fair. But, like, the fact that it says... From Stranger Things,
yeah.
Makes it feel like, okay, so the one prop. That I made. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You made. Which is wow. Cool because it was edited. That means they made this app, or they updated this app, like, after you made that box. And they were like, oh, I know a cool prop. It's that one M made.
That is a fun idea.
Right?
Hmm. Yeah, 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 yeah.
They were like, that's worth putting in the list.
Well, when your baby is the size of a box of chocolates, I hope that they're not at least, like, I hope they're not as pointy as a box of chocolates.
That would be probably painful. Volleyball, I feel like I can handle.
Yeah, yeah.
Box of chocolates, a little sharp, but yeah. Well, anyway, now that we've totally distracted from the high priestess of blood.
I really am trying to do, like a shiny yarn dangling in front of myself, like, just to, like... Wow, that was just such an awful story. Anyway, if you would like to go buy our merch for 50% off, and you're listening to this when this episode comes out, look out for an announcement sometime this week. And...
Oh, and our merch site is atwwdmerch.com.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and go get all of your goodies. We are cleaning house and making room for new stuff, so enjoy that while you can. And
yay, that's
why
we...
drink.